Good morning and welcome to the 32nd meeting in 2022 of the Local Government Housing and Planning Committee. Mark Griffin and Annie Wells are joining us remotely today. I remind all members and witnesses to ensure that their devices are on silent and that all other notifications are turned off during the meeting. The first item on our agenda today is to decide whether to take items 3, 4, 5 in private. Are members agreed? We are all agreed. We now turn to agenda item 2, which is to take evidence on the local governance review. We will hear from two separate panels of witnesses today. Our first panel, we are joined online by Councillor Sean McCauley, who's the Deputy Leader of North Ayrshire Council, Councillor Alex Nicol, who's the co-leader of Aberdeen City Council, and Councillor James Stockin, who's the leader of Orkney Islands Council. And we are joined in the room by Councillor Ewan Jardine, who is the leader of the Scottish Borders Council, and Councillor David Ross, who is the leader of Fife Council. And I welcome our witnesses to the meeting. Committee members will direct their questions to specific witnesses where possible, but if anyone else wishes to come in, please indicate your desire to do so to the clerks. And for those of you participating remotely, you can do this by typing an R in the chat box in BlueJeans. So I'd like to begin, and I'm going to actually direct this question, this kind of a question to set the kind of foundation of our conversation. So I'll actually direct it to all of you. So thinking broadly about the current challenges facing local government, I'd be interested in hearing about some of the biggest challenges your local authority is facing and what you would like to see in this week's budget to help address them and improve outcomes in your local areas. And I might start with somebody who's in the room and then go to the folks online. So David Ross, would you like to? You were looking like you were ready to go for it.
I was hoping you would avoid me, I mean, just to kick off, I mean, I think the obvious, concerns are about funding and, you know, certainty and sustainability of funding. I mean, I think our three top priorities in Fife are tackling poverty, supporting the local economy, and addressing climate change. And those are obviously all affected by, have been affected by the pandemic and now by cost of living crisis. So, you know, we are having to continue to put support in place for our communities as we did over the pandemic. I think the funding issue is probably the key one. And I mean, I think in the context of the discussion today, issues are around funding sustainability, that we have certainty and sustainability to continue providing services and to meet new and emerging needs, which has not been the case for a number of years now. I think removing the ring fencing and direction that we have as well in terms of that. I think the other big challenge we've got is in terms of recruitment and retention in a whole range of areas, and I'm sure we will get into it in more depth about the uncertainty about the National Care Service and obviously winter pressures on health and social care immediately, but the longer term future about that. I'll perhaps stop there and let others in.
Thanks very much for going first, and yep, clearly those issues are on our minds as well. I'm going to move to somebody online. Sean McCauley, would you like to come in with your to tell us about the biggest challenges and what you would like to see in this week's budget to help address them?
Thanks, Convener. Pretty similar, I'd imagine, I'm pretty similar to what all witnesses here are going to say, and that's financial uncertainty is the biggest concern for us. It's almost like a perfect storm, this budget, because there's huge rising demand and ever-challenging financial outlook. So I think from this budget on Thursday, we'd be looking for funding to support the priorities of certainly of North Ayrshire. So ours is pretty similar to other people's, which is poverty, climate change and local democracy. So we'd be looking for a budget that would support us locally to meet the needs. I think this review. I know it's been delayed, but I think it's quite timely, given the situation that we're in just now and given how we're all thinking about what is local government, what is local governance. And I think what we would be looking for is increased financial flexibilities from the government to allow us to meet our local needs. We would be open for a discussion. I know the Deputy First Minister has indicated that he's willing to listen to local authorities on that, and we've certainly been in a dialogue with them surrounding some of the ideas that we might have surrounding that. So I think for me that's what I would be looking for on Thursday. And hopefully we can get into a wee bit more of the detail in that as the discussion moves on this morning.
Thanks very much for that, Sean. I'm going to bring in Alex Nicol. And Alex, add new things if there's new ones, but don't feel all, you know, but yeah, go ahead. What are the challenges and what would you like to see in the budget?
I think all the witnesses this morning are going to answer this question in an extremely similar way, because ultimately it's going to come down to budgets and the impact that it's going to have on local councils. I think we all agree it's probably quite helpful to have a roadmap in terms of what local government financing is going to be. But unfortunately, we've hit, as Councillor McAuley pointed out, the perfect storm, where we've seen rocketing inflation, a huge increase in demand for our services, and at the time when we're actually facing real-term reductions in our funding. And I think, as councils, we all probably have very similar priorities. I think everybody on this call will put poverty, climate change, and their local economy very highly up a list of services that we need to be providing. But I do think that the actual cash crisis that we face is absolutely huge. And it's at a time when councils have faced COVID, we've come into a recovery period, but we've then encountered an economic set of circumstances that we simply cannot deal with in terms of our reserves and other policies that we have in place normally. And I think really the big challenge is going to be how we help local government to actually deliver on all the policies and procedures that we want to see in our country.
Thanks very, very much for that. I'm just out of curiosity, so your priorities locally are climate, poverty and...
I think the local economy. Obviously, the northeast of Scotland has a very energy-based economy, and that obviously impacts hugely on how we actually fit into the national economy, because obviously energy is a key factor in driving forward growth.
Thanks very much for that. Okay, I'm going to go to Councillor James Stockton.
Good morning, and thank you for giving us a chance to give some evidence from the far north here. We have two of the top risks on our risk register, but funnily enough, the financial package we get from government is only number two. Number one is the other risk that we have, and it's the sustainability of our ferry fleet. And for us to replace our ferry fleet with new ferries and the infrastructure, we're speaking about four times our budget, over £400 million. And it's absolutely critical because our internal ferry service is older on average than CalMax ferry service, and vessels are getting holes in the bottom and they are becoming unsafe. So our biggest request to the government this year is to start and give us a mortgage payment over the next 30 years to replace those ferries and the infrastructure, or else we will be in real jeopardy. But beyond that, for Orkney being the smallest local authority, we look at ourselves in the suite of the three island authorities that are more or less similar size. but Orkney gets £375 per person less than Shetland and £698 less than the Western Isles this year in cash terms after all the machinations of the formulas. And something that the other request I have of the DFM is that something is done about that this year, because we really are the canary in the coal mine. Our services are stretched and we are at the point of failure.
Thank you very much for that, and thank you for raising the issue of the ferry fleet, a very important issue. Councillor Ewan Jardine.
Yeah, thank you, and thanks again for the invitation to come along and speak this morning. And I think there's obviously a lot of similar themes to other councils, and that won't be obviously a shock to anyone in the room there. But for the Scottish Borders, we're a very rural authority. We have two major, Hoyeke and Galla Shields. Galla Shields, great with the train link, fantastic, really re-energised the area. But the transport, public transport to other areas in the Scottish Borders is a real concern. We've piloted one in Berwickshire called Pingo, where you can dial a, basically dial a bus. That's helping a lot of people. If you were at the city, tuned into the city deal a couple of weeks ago, they were talking there how that has helped employability. However, that's Berwickshire, that's not the Scottish Borders. So if you're not in Berwickshire, you really are struggling for employability. And another issue is loneliness. And I think that's something that the Scottish Government and councils need to be looking at post-pandemic, is loneliness. I read a stat, I think it was Harvard University or Stanford, one of the big ones in America, had stated that loneliness can age you quicker than smoking. That is devastating in rural areas, and we shouldn't be going through that in this in 2022 or 2023 or 2024 or going forward. So how do we tackle rural loneliness? Better public transport, better ways that people can get around. So for us, that's a real essential, and we're having to make tough decisions. Do we cut a bus or do we not cut a bus? These are lifelines for people to get out and about into the major hamlets, like city towns, like Galla Shields, Hoyeke, etc. That connectivity then on to Edinburgh. But also another thing is leisure trusts, the funding for leisure trusts, and I'm sure every council will be the same. We are having to look at different ways of funding them, different ways of helping them because of the energy crisis. £300,000, £500,000 that they hadn't put into their funding packages, into their budget. They've been hit very hard by that. What does that mean? Swimming pools will close. Gyms will close. What does that mean? The health of the country, the health of the region will go down. What does that mean? The NHS will be even more burdened by that. So I think it's really important we support leisure trusts, we support public transport. Somebody talked on again about health and social care. Carers, there is a carer crisis, not just in my region, but the country. That really needs to be delivered, and it must be given local priorities. As a rural area, they're 15 minutes at a house. That's not really giving much care. But then jumping in a car, going somewhere else, going in another place, it's very difficult to attract carers to that occupation. So we really need to work on that. If we had money, we had flexibility to deliver better there. So apart from copying what everyone else is saying, because everyone's made clear points on what priorities, but for us from a rural area, that's vital. And getting job stimulus is even more vital. Keeping people, that retention, we call it brain drain, young people leaving, going off to the city, and maybe then coming back later on in life. But can we keep them there? So they grow here, they're born on the borders, they stay in the borders, and they retire in the borders. That's what we're looking for in the Scottish Borders, just creating that economy. So for us, it's that rural issue. We need funding. Thanks.
Thank you very much for that, and certainly bringing some new, and definitely as a Highlands and Islands MSP, I recognise some of those issues that you've outlined there. Just going to move on to talk about the New Deal for local government, and I'd be interested to hear what you would like to see in the New Deal between the Scottish Government and the local government, and how could any deal help improve outcomes for individuals and communities that you represent. And maybe I'll start with someone online. So I'll start with Councillor Nicol, and then I'll go to Councillor Jardine.
Thank you very much, convener. I think the first thing I would say is we need to be more involved when proposals are coming forward and are still at their formative stage. I do think there is often a justified feeling in local government that we are being presented with a plan and, you know, we haven't necessarily fed in. I think already in our discussion, we've heard from the five councillors that our areas are very different. Some of our problems are very different, and the solutions to those problems at times are very different. So I think when we are involved at the beginning, we probably can contribute to a better outcome, a better policy, a better idea on where we want to go. But if we're only being involved once plans have been essentially formulated, then I think A, it's very difficult to change those plans, and B, we don't necessarily come to the best outcome, because what works in the Borders doesn't necessarily work in Aberdeen, and it doesn't necessarily work with my colleagues in the Islands. Scotland is a very diverse country, and the local authorities that represent the population really do at times have quite unique problems, and one solution doesn't always fit for everyone. And I think that's a really key point that we need to pick up in our movement to work more collegiately together, that we have to understand that what works in Glasgow doesn't necessarily work in the Highlands, doesn't necessarily work in Aberdeen. And I think we have to have flexibility built in to our discussions.
Thank you very much for that. Councillor Jardine, what are your thoughts on the New Deal for local government?
Yeah, thank you. Very, very similar, actually, because I think if you're in Kirkwall, and if you're in Kirkcaldy, if you're in Kilmarnock or Kelso, you've got very different needs, but you're still in Scotland. And we need to remember that the 32 local authorities make up Scotland, are Scotland, and Scotland's reputation comes from the local authorities. So wherever you go, it depends if you see the clean streets. I think we found out just during the Fringe Festival, when the streets were getting, you know, dirty, the bins weren't collected, the reputation of Scotland quite quickly plummeted on that international stage. You could see people from Canada on the news saying, oh, I didn't expect it to be like this, etc. And who looks after the bins? The local authority. And I think that's what the key relationship is. Scottish Government has its place and it delivers things, but the local authorities deliver on the ground. And we need to, that's part of the New Deal, needs to be, actually, the local authorities know what is unique to their place. So I know nothing what goes on in Kirkwall. I don't know about Kirkcaldy, don't know about Kilmarnock, but I can tell you about Kelso. And I think that's important. We know what's going on in our local authority. Everyone's got their own unique culture. So the Scotland is a great country. We've got our identity as a country, but we've all got identity of where we're from. And I think that's the New Deal. Everybody needs to be around that table and look and saying, OK, how does that work? And we need that flexibility to deliver different things. As I talked earlier, the public transport for us is very different to the public transport in Edinburgh. You can get a bus every 20 minutes if you're going out to Curry, coming back into the city. Galashiels, you might not get that bus for hours. So it's really key that we get this right in terms of every local authority has its own differences. We are Scotland, but we're very different, and that needs to be taken into it. We can't all just be cookie cutter put through the same machine. Thanks.
Thank you very much for that. Yes, it's certainly true that Scotland has, and it's one of our richnesses, isn't it, that we've got such a diversity across the country. I'm just going to invite anyone else who would like to come in on this and comment on the New Deal for local government. David?
Thanks. Is that, I'm quite sure about the microphones, is that?
Yes, you actually don't need to touch your microphones.
Okay,
the
right.
Broadcast, we've got somebody here, wonderful person here to operate all of that for us.
Thanks very much. I think we need to have a degree of honesty here, you know, if we are going to go forward. You know, my view is that, you know, a good relationship between central government and local government benefits us all and benefits all our communities. But, you know, I think we need to look at this in context. We're not starting with a blank sheet. And there is huge suspicion in local government based on our experience over the past 10 years of the Scottish Government's approach to this. And it does seem, I think, to many of us in local government that, you know, they talk about partnership when it suits Scottish Government, but otherwise we tend to be ignored. And I think I would look back over the last 10 years, not just the financial issues, which are huge, but what we've seen is a programme increasing centralisation and, I would say, disempowerment of local government. And you can talk about the removal of police and fire starting there, and you can have an argument whether that was good or bad. But then we've had increasing involvement in education with establishment of regional collaboratives, bypassing councils and going straight to schools with the PEF funding, and rather which has actually reduced the ability of councils to have strategic interventions in education. We had the Community Empowerment Act, which, to be honest, posed councils as a barrier to community engagement, which for me is exactly the opposite. That's what we're about, and it seemed to suggest that communities needed protecting against councils. I think the local governance review itself almost started off with, what can we take off local government and give to the third sector? What could they do better than us? And I think we're now seeing, the debate around the National Care Service, which seems to be removing responsibilities and possibly significant numbers of staff and assets away from local government. So the underlying premise there seems to many of us in local government is that local government is a problem, whereas actually, and we saw it during the pandemic, local government is a solution to a lot of these problems, and it's our delivery, that people rely on in our communities to actually support them. So I think we need to look at that in that long-term context. If you're asking me about what it would take to work, then I think the fiscal framework is fundamental, and a decent, sustainable level of funding, of core funding, and things like tourist tax and parking levy are fine, but they are no substitute for core funding. Removal of the ring fencing elements, a real joint setting of priorities and that are deliverable and realistic, and not just that are imposed on local government. And I think, as others have said, that recognition of diversity across and different solutions in different places. So that's really where I'm coming from at this point.
Can I just ask you, you talked there about We're not starting with a blank slate, and there's huge suspicion. So obviously, if there's suspicion, we need to build trust. And those three things that you just outlined at the end, so core funding, removal of ring fencing, and the joint setting of priorities, would that be the kind of thing that would help to ease the suspicion and move towards trust?
I think it would help that, certainly, but again, the experiences, we've been talking about fiscal frameworks and things for years, and it's never been delivered. So, there needs to be a demonstration of that good faith, I think, from government. And part of that is the funding and the longer term planning and that.
Thank you very much. I'm now going to bring in James Stockin.
Yeah, thank you very much, Convener. I just want to absolutely reiterate that thing. Anything must be built on trust if we're going to get anywhere with any kind of new deal. And the other big aspect is we've got to reduce bureaucracy. Being the smallest council, every single thing we do has got to be reported at the same level as large councils. It's absolutely debilitating if we want to make sure that we provide service. And I think with the other thing, a new deal has got to be promoting success, celebrating achievements. Local government has had reduced budgets for years, but yet the number of things we do has been continuing to be done in the community and sustained in a way that the public don't know. But we must get away from always criticising when there's failure. We must make sure that we can get through times of failure, but we must actually get the message out that we're very successful in delivering services.
Thanks very much for that. Yes, and I agree with that. I find that when I'm talking to people locally where I live, most people don't seem to understand what their local authority is giving them, and they tend to move to conversations about the national government. So absolutely, I think in the minds of people in Scotland, we need to do some work there to gain that respect and understanding of what is delivered at a local level. Anybody else want to come in on that one? No? Okay. I'm now going to move to... Oh, I've got another question. Hang on a minute. Sticking with the New Deal. Okay, so yeah, so just on the so the recent update from the Scottish Government to the committee spoke about agreeing a new deal in advance of the next financial year, and I'm just be interested to hear if you think that that's a realistic timescale and what would need to be agreed before a deal is struck. Anybody got any thoughts on that timescale? Feels quite tight, but Sean, you'd like to come in.
Thanks, Convener. I would welcome it within the next few months. I'd be a little bit sceptical if we could actually get there and make it meaningful. I think it's more important, and I'm sure all colleagues across Scotland would say, it's we need to get this right, we need to get this new deal right. And if that takes a little bit of time, then I think so be it, to be honest with you. I think the principles are there. We've had the Community Empowerment Act talking about, you know, financial flexibilities and things like that. So I think we've got the bones of a deal there. I think we just need to have a more open discussion. The budget right now is obviously taken. That's the priority just now, locally and nationally. So I think once that's delivered and that's done, we can then have a decision. If that's going to be achieved by the end of March, I'm not too sure. I would need to see a little bit more detail in how that's going to work. Obviously, we need to go through COSLA, and we need to have that opportunity for toing and froing. And I don't know if we're going to push something through, if we're going to achieve that as such. But certainly, it would be welcome. I think it's high time that we do have a new deal in place, and we've got an agreement in place that we can both be comfortable with.
Thanks very much for that. I mean, in a way, Councillor David Ross was talking about we've been doing this for the last 10 years. We've had this local governance review that's been going on, I think, since 2017. So maybe the conversation has been happening. As you say, we've got the pieces, the elements for the conversation. So it could be that if we can build that trust and have that dialogue that you're talking about, things could potentially move quite quickly. I'd like to bring in Alex Nicol.
Thank you very much, Convener. I would agree with Councillor Macaulay. I think we are facing quite a tight timeline there, and I'm not totally convinced that that's achievable before the next financial year. Obviously, councils are now going to have to, later this week, go and take on board what the Deputy First Minister says in terms of the budget process. By the time we process that into our own financial profiling, that will in itself take a bit of time. It will probably be the major thing for most council leaders to be involved in. And I would be concerned that we are maybe setting an arbitrary point in time when perhaps what we should be saying is we need to have the discussions. And if it takes slightly longer, then so be it. I'm not a great fan of sometimes saying we want to do something by a given point on a calendar, because for all sorts of reasons, there may be issues that arise that actually deserve and require further inquiry, further research, further input. So I'm not totally convinced that simply saying by the new financial year we should be there, and I'm not convinced that it's actually something that all 32 local authorities will be in a position to actually say that they are content. And I think that is an important thing, that we take all 32 local authorities with us on this journey.
Thank you very much for that perspective. We're now going to move on to a different theme. So thanks so much for contributions so far. And I'm going to bring in Willie Coffey, who's going to pick up on local governance review.
Yeah, thanks very much, convener, and good morning to everyone. Forgive my croaky voice this morning. Could I take you back to the local governance review itself, which, as I understand, kicked off in 2017, with most of the work being done in 2018-19 and then paused for obvious reasons for COVID. It's just to get a few sentences from each of you about what you think has been achieved in the local governance review to date and whether you're satisfied with, not, perhaps not with the timescale of the progress, but the content and delivery of what has been discussed. Could I maybe start with Councillor Ross?
Thanks. Yeah. Perhaps a wee bit of a jaundiced view about it. I think at the start there were real concerns that it was to take things away from local government. Now I think in the discussion and the case that Cosler put up, we kind of moved away from that. I think my own view is we felt, regardless of the pandemic, even before the pandemic, it was kind of losing impetus a bit, and it was Cosler that was kind of trying to revive it with the three empowerments, the functional, fiscal and community empowerment, and saying that's what we need. I would hope that if we can reinvigorate it, that we will concentrate on those, because there are magnificent examples of all those kind of things, and particularly community empowerment, going on in all councils, and we need to build on that. And I think it does lay the foundations for some kind of new deal going forward if that's what we're going to achieve.
Okay, thanks, Councillor Ross. Councillor Jardine.
Yeah, thank you. And I think For me, Dave, Councillor Ross has got through a lot of the points there, and we need to remember it's a review of government and not government. And I think that's a very key thing we need to remember here. It's how do we deliver on the ground? How do we make it more efficient? And I think, again, I want to flip back to the trust thing. We look at the review and we think, actually, what is this wanting to do? Is it wanting to rip everything back out, centralise everything, or is it wanting to give us more autonomy, more flexibility, more opportunity to deliver on the ground? So, again, it's gone back to the trust, and I think that's just the key. Maybe the key words that's going to come out of this morning's session is the trust. Are we trusting Scottish Government? Are they going to review this appropriately, or are they going to review it? And if we just slice that away from them, they'll not notice, or they don't think. So I think that's really important for me, is the trust.
Okay. Councillor Macaulay, just progress since the government's review was started. Could you share a few thoughts with us?
Yeah, I think actually, given the role local government played in the response to the pandemic, I actually think it's quite timely to have this discussion at this point and see the establishment a lot of things during that time. I know certainly in North Ayrshire, we were probably in a really good place to deal with the pandemic, given the work we had done previously surrounding community empowerment. When we're talking about trust for local and national government, there's also a key element for communities to trust local and national government as well. I think the pandemic and the response to that, and how we got into communities and worked with them and co-produced a lot of the services that supported people during that time, that built a lot of that trust that we might not have had previously. So I think that's a key factor that we need to remember. The trust is also with our communities as well. And I think we're at a good place for that just now.
Thanks for that. Councillor Stalkin, a few comments from yourself about the governance review from your experience.
Well, we have not a very good experience of this, because we were one of the pilots that was suggested to develop a single island authority model. And we made significant progress here with the whole of our health board agreeing, along with the council, to a different model to take that forward to government. But the shutters came down when we met with members of the Cabinet, particularly the former Health Secretary, and that went off the pitch. It was in the programme for government in 2017 to develop a single islands authority, and we still see that as the very best way for us to have an to promote integration, because we can't see how the National Care Service is going to work, having another body on an island. So we'd be very keen for this to be reinvigorated, but we were very disappointed with all the effort we put in, and it came to nothing.
OK, Okay, thanks for that. Councillor Nicol, lastly, to save the day, did anything positive come from the local governance review in your experience?
Yes, I think it did. I think, you know, colleagues have pointed out community empowerment, and I think that has been a really major area where we have actually made some absolutely good progress. And I think it served as well, the work we had done in the run-up to the pandemic. And through the pandemic, I think that did actually serve us very well. And I think now that we are facing new challenges with the economic situation that the whole country faces, I do actually think that we are in a better place than we might have been otherwise. So I think there is a positive to be taken out from there, yes.
Mm-hmm. Thank you for that. I'll just have one more question just to ask. Do you think, because of the discussion we've had there, do you think we actually gave communities the expectation that there was more power, more funding coming down the line in part of the discussion within the review? Did we give that impression, do you think, during the recent years of the governance review itself, and what direction of travel should we head in as we move towards trying to conclude this? We'll start with Councillor Nicol, because you're on screen.
I think there is more to do, but I think we have begun the journey, and I think communities are seeing improvements and connections with local government in terms of all sorts of things that we are now doing to empower our communities, not only in terms of speaking and seeking advice, seeking to consult more. So we haven't completed the journey by any manner of means, but I think we are on the correct road, and I'm sure different local authorities across the country are at different stages of that journey. But I can only speak for Aberdeen City Council. But I think we have begun a journey that is positive, it's engaging with our communities, and I think that while we maybe haven't achieved everyone's expectations yet, we're certainly on the right road, and we are certainly taking communities with us on that journey.
Thanks for that, Councillor Nicol. Just to see if it's going round the whole panel with the same questions, is there another view from any of our councillors this morning about that kind of expectation of more power, more funding to offer an alternative? Is that a good thing to promote, or should we carry on with that line, or should we be cautious about that? Councillor Jardim.
Yeah, thanks. So we've recently did an admin policy plan, and part of that is community empowerment and how we can utilise communities more effectively. And I think more does need to be publicised. Actually, communities can make a big impact. I believe during COVID we saw the difference when resilience teams popped up all over the place in communities. They're ready, and I think that gave communities an appetite. Actually, we can play into the bigger system. We can be part of the wheel that goes round. So anything that can be done to help support communities, and someone said about trusting communities, trusting government, I think it needs to bounce back down. We need to trust communities more than they need to trust us, and I think that's important. And it's that trust filtering down. So, yeah, I think more can be done. I think the journey started, but I think councils, and what I feel for Scottish Borders Council, a lot of time when it first got the money, we don't know what direction to use it, where to utilise it, how to do it. So it's a journey that's still in progress. So I think more conversation between communities, national government, local government is needed just to hit the right spot.
Thanks very much, Councillor. Councillor Ross?
Yeah, just a couple of kind of observations on that. I mean, I think everybody's right in terms of, you know, the pandemic. It was all hands to the pumps, as it were, and, you know, local authorities did support those communities and worked very well with them. And I think that's something we want to capture and continue as we get back to kind of business as usual. But I mean, in terms of both, you know, community empowerment and local governance review, I detect there was probably an expectation in third sector and community groups that because of the squeeze on local government, they didn't get much out of local government, and it was an opportunity they might get more from central government if there was a direct relationship there, which I think is probably, I would say, is short-sighted. I mean, I think we certainly have had a culture of partnership and
community involvement in Fife for many, many years, going back to reorganisation. But I think one of two other points. I mean, one is, again, it's not just about local government. I think if you look at the health service, for instance, I think it was actually a shock to them that they were subject to the kind of the community empowerment powers of participation in kind of closure of, I can think of an example of closure of an out-of-hours service, and a community requested the right to participate in that decision. And I think it was a shock to them that actually it applied to them. And I think, you know, that let's not just concentrate on local government. If we are talking about, you know, public services as a whole, we need to look at those. The other element is the participatory budgeting there, which I'm a great advocate of, but I think there was a mistake by the Scottish Government to impose that arbitrary target of how much, can't remember, was it 1% or 1% to do it. And I think that encouraged local authorities to look at achieving a target rather than embedding the culture of participatory and actually winning the case that it is a good thing. So, you know, if there had been more, I think, discussion around that and more flexibility to work, there, I think we would have got further with that.
Thanks for that, David. Any final comment on that, Councillor Stockton, Councillor McCauley?
Councillor McCauley.
I'll come in first thing. So right. I think the initial question that you had asked them regarding funding and power, I think we've always tried to be as transparent with our communities as possible. It's obviously it's difficult for us when we are uncertain in what funding lies ahead of us as well. And I think that goes back to the trust element, that sometimes communities see us as, you know, being underhand when it's not really the case. It's actually just the fact that we are trying to be as transparent as possible. We certainly have been on a journey to try and, you know, reimagine what people think of the local authority. We can't be all things to all people all of the time. We sort of see ourselves as facilitators in some of the work that we do. But within that becomes trust again. So we've got to trust local authorities to make the decisions within the communities, even within that local authority, to make good decisions to find out, will this work in this community centre? Will this work in this town centre? And that's where we want to be. And I think in North Ayrshire, we've certainly, the way that we use the Community Power Act to establish locality partnerships and split a local authority into six localities with councillors, with community reps on that, with funding behind it so we could fund our own local priorities. That's built that trust locally for us. And we look, as we're looking ahead, we're trying to reimagine what locality partnerships are looking like. And hopefully through the new deal and through new powers coming to local government, we can actually empower locality partnerships to have some of these decisions as well, which I think will be a real strength for local government. And just the final point on participatory budgeting, I think North Ayrshire was, I think it may have been the only council to achieve that target of 1%. And we've done that not just through participatory budgeting, which is, you know, it's great and there's great events, but actually also through other mechanisms as well, allowing locality partnerships to have, you know, power over street scene budgets. So it's actually within the local community they can decide if they want flowers planted, trees planted, if they want extra car parking spaces, or if they want to take car parking spaces away. And that's real community power, empowerment in action.
Thanks very much for that. Lastly, Councillor Stockton.
Yeah, thank you very much. Just a word from the islands. I mean, we're at this kind of size already that you would be thinking of as your communities. So our authority is a little bit like the communities that you're trying to reach. But we're even more granular than that because we've got a fantastic community council system below us, which we have a great degree of parity esteem with them. And, you know, we reach in really into the smallest areas. So when this came along, you know, community empowerment, we kind of believe we were doing it already on the islands. So we just want to make sure that, you know, we can show these examples because we think we've got something that can benefit other places.
Thanks very much for that, everybody. Very helpful. Convener, back to you.
Thanks, Willie. We're now going to move to a question from Annie Wells, who's joining us online.
Hi, good morning, everyone, and thanks very much for coming. Everyone sort of touched on community empowerment there, so I've just got a question based on that. How can all communities and people within them feel that they can influence decisions in their local area? And I'm talking in particular an example of what impact can community empowerment efforts have in more deprived communities, and how has that worked out in recent years?
Do you want to direct it to someone? Pick on someone first.
Could I pick on Councillor Macaulay on that one, please? Because he sort of mentioned the trust and transparency element to it.
Councillor Macaulay.
Yeah. Thanks for that question. I think that's a really important point. I think one of the things that we always say in the local authorities, you always get the same people volunteering to do this, that and the next thing. But what we need to do is actually reach more marginalised communities, so people that are in high levels of deprivation, people with disabilities, you know, people who don't necessarily want to come forward. And that's how, even when I was talking about the locality partnerships that we developed, there's 10 community reps, 10 councillors on it, so there's parity esteem that way. But even within the partnerships, we went out into communities within towns. So we went to local community centres and we invited people along to say, actually, yes, as a town, we can come together. But actually, even within that town, there's different communities. The key point that people always come back to us and say is, we're not going to come to these things, we're not going to give an opinion if you don't act on what you're going to do. So you need to show us that you're actually acting on things. But that's what we've always tried to evidence, that we are doing and we're listening to people. The thing is, we don't have the solutions to all the problems. The solutions need to come from people to say, this is what's going to work best for us. We can come up with these great plans, but actually, if we don't have the community buy-in, then it's not going to go anywhere. Probably another example of that we've done in North Ayrshire is when we established a child poverty board that's kind of scoping out now to just a wider poverty board. And in that, we decided to take a thematic approach. So rather than just council services come together, we held what we called mini inquiries, which is not exactly like a citizens' assembly, but it's the same idea of it. And we invited parent councils along, we invited people from community centres along to come and tell us, what do you think about accessing the council? Where should the council be based? One of the things they said was we should be more based in schools, because that's where a lot of people go to. So we're now doing a whole bit of work of reimagining what we can offer people in their own local community. So that's been a real help to us. And I think that co-production of services will mean longer term better outcomes for people.
Thanks for that. Anybody else want to come in on Annie's question? Councillor Jardine.
Yeah, thank you, Annie, for the question. And for me, it was just touched on there by Sean, Councillor Macaulay, around conversations. So when I took over the leadership, I went round all 11 wards in the Scottish Borders with the chief executive, with the directors, with the other ward members in that ward. I went round all 11 on a summer tour we called Community Conversations. And from that Community Conversations, we got feedback straight away. People were expecting us to sit on the stage and they would rant and they had a big list. But when we said, no, it's one-to-one conversations with the people who make the decisions at the council, they were shocked that that was happening, because that had never, ever happened with the council. We'd sat in, wouldn't say our iron chamber, but we'd iron throne, but we'd sat there for a long time without going out and speaking to people. And now the council on Thursday, our full council, we have a paper coming that declares the issues need to be considered as part of the budget process and realistic prioritised plan will have to be developed in assisting community councils and area partnerships. The feedback will be shared with area partnerships and community councils, and consultation will go with them to delivering the aims going forward into the future, 2023, 2024, and we'll be doing it again in the spring in 2023. And I think that's important. It's letting communities know we're coming, we're speaking to them. And we talk about local areas and deprived areas, and we consistently talk how we've got areas of deprivation, but every year it's the same question, areas of deprivation, how do we help? We really do need to start tackling the issues in those areas of deprivation by going into those areas of deprivation and saying what locally, what you'll find is the communities and the areas of deprivation are more than likely the best communities in the whole region. They're together, they hold their own fairs and festivals, but sometimes they do feel disconnected from the big wheel, the big things that are going on. So it's getting into these communities, having the conversations and what we can make. We can't make the world change overnight, but bit by bit we can, and it has having those conversations. And the people who know their community are the people who live in their community, and we need to remember that first. So community conversations are the main starter point for getting into communities and listening.
Thank you very much for that. And I think Alex Nicol would like to come in as well.
Thank you very much, Convener. It was very much to follow up on what some colleagues have actually said. I think you really do have to take this down at times into a granular level, because I think historically some communities have not trusted any form of government in fairness. And there has been a lot of work done in communities, but it's not even down to community councils. It's to take it beyond that, because I think, you know, here in Aberdeen, we've certainly progressed our local outcome improvement plan down to the point where we can actually go out with officers, very senior officers, into communities to do walkabouts, to speak to people on the ground and actually listen to what they say they want for their street, their community. And I think, you know, some colleagues pointed out earlier, I can't remember who it was, but, you know, it's schools seen as a hub, actually trying to use the school and the various services that can be located there to actually pull the community together. Because at times, things like community councils, while they're very, very valuable organisations, they often cover quite large areas. And within that area, the actual people who live there see themselves as a number of disparate communities within that area. And I think that's the level that we have to pull this down to in order to get the proper feedback from the communities that we're actually seeking to serve. And I think, you know, across the country, I'm sure other towns and cities and places have done the same kind of work that we've done. But you've really got to get into that level to start getting the proper feedback, because historically there has been a barrier there that we really do need to break down.
Thank you. Anybody else want to come in on that? Well, happy to move. Okay. Councillor Ross.
Very briefly, yeah, I mean, the experience, I think, mirrors what's been said. But it is about getting down to a fairly local level, and, you know, Fife, I think, the third largest local authority in population terms, but we have seven area committees to get down to that local level. Each of those has a different approach depending on the circumstances in their area, and particularly in some of the urban areas. I mean, working with tenants and residents associations, and we have, you know, housing participation officers there to support. But I think one of the things that you know, again, it's a function of the cutbacks that we've had to impose, is a lack of real community development support in some of these communities to, you know, assist with that capacity building. I mean, one of the initiatives we are trying now is a community social work approach. I mean, going back to almost recreating what was going on, I think, in the 80s in some areas, and that really seems to be bearing some fruit. So we're hoping that we can scale that up and expand it.
Thanks very much for that. I'm keen to move on, and I'm going to bring in Mark Griffin, who is joining us also online, and he's going to bring in the whole piece of conversation around funding and fiscal framework. Mark.
Thanks, Convener. Good morning. COSLA talked last year about really the lack of fiscal empowerment of local government, talk about reduced board budget funding, too much ring fencing. And I wonder if witnesses would recognise that situation, what impact that's having on delivery of local priorities. I mean, are we essentially moving to a system where councils can only afford to deliver their statutory functions and what they are being ring-fence funded to do without any consideration of local priorities, and perhaps come to Councillor Jardine first, as I think you touched on this in earlier answers.
Yeah, thank you for the question. And it's the flexibility to do and what we need to do and deliver for our region is vitally important. I talked earlier, you're right, about how everyone is different across the country. We are Scotland, but we're very unique local authorities, and it's important we have that flexibility to deliver. So last year, I think we had £100,000 spare to actually look on local priorities, and that £100,000 wasn't a recurring £100,000. It was only for that 1 year, so we could only put in a project that would work for that year, then move away. But if we had the ability to stretch that and deliver on that continued basis where we could put in consistency, that would make a real impact. And if we want to raise funding, we have to raise the council tax. And if we're raising the council tax, we're impacting on people's lives and a cost of living crisis going forward. So it's really important that we have flexibility to deliver priorities. So I put forward my admin policy plan. Hopefully we can get a lot of that done through really good work and looking at things, being inventive, delivering on services. But it's hard to deliver priorities for the local government and local authorities that are key to our areas when we're getting tied down and hamstrung under things that we're forced to do under the Scottish Government's priorities. And I think there is a very vast difference. A 50-50 split may be fantastic. That might be the way forward. But we do need to have that opportunity to release and use the skill sets that we have at local government level to deliver really in the communities what people want and what they're looking for.
Anybody else want to come in on that? David Ross.
Thanks, Convener. Yeah, I think in terms of that overall kind of financial picture, that I think there's probably three aspects I'd highlight. First of all, we have local government, as demonstrated by Audit Scotland, we've undergone a 4.2% real terms cut in core funding since 2013-14, unlike other parts of the public sector. And I think if you go back and look back historically to what local government's share of funding has been, and we'll see that has reduced quite dramatically. And even taken out police and fire and taken out the recent social security, you've probably since 2012 or so, it's reduced from what was 30% of the Scottish kind of core budget to between 24% and 22%. So that's been the level of the cuts that we've seen, and that does if half the budget is on education, and really there are limits to the savings or cuts you can make in education. Another kind of 10-15% is social care, which is under enough pressure. In terms of cuts, it falls on that last kind of 20 third or so of services, and a lot of those, and including statutory services, street cleaning and grounds maintenance, are cut to the bone now. And I think the third element is that ring fencing, and not only does it constrain local authorities to put money where we feel we need to, but it increases the bureaucracy and the reporting and monitoring that goes with it. And I think this year, COSLA has had the leaders group has had to look at the distribution of over 70 different funds and small pots of money. I think last year it was over 100 we looked at. And, there is no good reason why a lot of those couldn't be consolidated and just trust local government to deliver on those things.
Thank you very much. Yes, it seems to be quite across the funding landscape, quite a few pots of money, and there feels like things do need to come together a bit more. I'd like to bring in James Stockin.
Yeah, thank you very much. I just want to continue on from Councillor Ross, because for us on the smallest budget, by the time that the ring-fenced or directed funding is carved up, The quantum we get is so small that the requirement for the bureaucracy of reporting back is often, you know, completely disproportionate. So we end up with more staff, and particularly in areas like ourselves where we have single dependencies and very small teams, it takes people's attention away from delivering the services that they should be delivering for better outcomes for the public. So I would absolutely concur that we need to find a new modus operandi for doing this. And I cast my mind back to the Concordat, which was decided very quickly, and we were released into a place where we focused on outcomes. And I think we need to reinvent that or look at it as quickly as we possibly can.
Thanks for that. And Sean McCauley, you'd like to come in too.
Yeah, thanks for that, convener. Just to go back to the original point, I think all local authorities have highlighted just the challenge it's going to be to meet our objectives this year, given what we currently know and have. That obviously might change on Thursday. One of the things that we've long spoke about is the need for community, local economies and local to have, I suppose what I'm trying to say is to have the powers locally in order to meet our needs. And right now we are going to struggle to do that. One of the things that I wanted to highlight was just about the context in which we are having and setting this budget. We've had record inflation. We've obviously had to then set pay awards to meet the demands for our own workers, which was the absolute right thing to do. That's obviously put financial pressures on other areas of our budget and of the Scottish budget as well. But I think it was the right thing to do. And I think when we're talking about the financial settlement, absolutely to have a conversation with the Scottish Government and bring them in to highlight just the challenges we're having as well. But I think other spheres of government, such as the UK Government, to come in and say, look, this is the context we are in just now in Scotland. And I think we need to maybe reimagine how we fund all our local services from all spheres of government.
Thanks. And Alex Nicholl.
Thank you very much, convener. I think the thing that strikes me with ring fencing always is we impose a set of rules that, once again, don't always fit for every single council across the nation. But I think what I come back to from this question is something we've covered several times already in this meeting, and that's the key word, trust. I think we have to trust each other that we are actually interested in delivering for our communities and the people that we have asked to be allowed to serve. And that trust, I think, is a key area where we can make progress and perhaps address some of the issues that colleagues have brought up, and specifically in regard to this question. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Mark, I believe you've got some more questions.
Yeah, thanks for those answers. I wanted to touch on how the new fiscal framework could actually work in practice, because, you know, we've heard about principles that would sit behind it, but actually very little technical detail as to how it would operate. Perhaps it'd come to David Ross first, since you talked about the proportion of the Scottish Government that's going to councils reducing, and just to ask essentially what is the sort of the ideal financial relationship that you would like to see between national government and local government? Are you looking for a fixed share of government budget? How would that fiscal framework work in practice?
Not sure that I can claim to be talking for COSLA or all local authorities, but I mean, it seems to me that if we had an arrangement where local government had a set share of the kind of the Scottish budget, that would give us certainty and would be fair and hopefully sustainable. And if the Scottish budget went up, then, you know, our funding would go up. If it went down, it would go down, but at the moment it just goes down whatever the budget seems to be. So I personally think that would be a good starting point for that. But again, you know, the second
point, I think, is that ring fencing and, you know, freeing up and giving local authorities flexibility in terms of that. But I think that proportion, and I think it was an arrangement which we had over a number of years on capital, and I think that was kind of fixed. My recollection is it was kind of fixed at 26%, but that's gone out the window in recent years as well.
Anybody else want to come in on that question? No, doesn't look like it. Mark, have you got any more questions?
Yep, just the last question briefly, Kumira, is just to ask about the multi-year nature of this year's resource capital spending review, whether that's given any certainty to local authorities in terms of financial and workforce planning. Just to see if anyone had any views on multi-year plans.
Councillor Ross.
Sorry, coming again. I think we all would welcome that kind of certainty going forward. And the resource spending review, I mean, gave us a degree of that. But events have moved on, and that was looking at giving us flat cash. Given inflation, energy costs and the demands we've seen coming from the cost of living crisis, flat cash is not going to cut it. And local COSLA has identified, you know, even to stand still requires across local government, I think, £612 million based on a survey of the budget gaps that we've got. And when you add next year's pay onto that, you're looking at north of a £1 billion. Now, you know, that's perhaps optimistic, but it gives you an idea of the scale of the challenge that we're facing.
Thanks. Councillor Jardine.
Yeah, thanks. And it's the 3 years. It sounds great. It sounds wonderful. And I remember a meeting with the Deputy First Minister recently. He said, well, year three is going to be really bad, so we're not going to give you as much year one, not as much year two. And you're, okay. How do we know that? We need that stability we need to be able to deliver. And we sit there, and I've just had a budget meeting yesterday. We're looking and said, this might be what we're going to deliver, but it might change in the next few days. And then the next few days, it might change after that. And you know, things come down the pipeline. COVID came down. The cost of living crisis comes up. The energy prices drop. And it's how are we able to jump on top of that and be on top of that for our communities? If we're getting flat cash, if it's reduced, if we're looking at different venues, we need the stability. We need so we can plan structures and we can plan and implement. Local government is fantastic at making the most of what it gets, but it'd be really good if we had that chance to go, right, okay, we've got that flat, but you'll get this if this happens, you'll get this if that happens. But we don't get that certainty. You're getting this, deal with it. If we just had that certainty, if this happens, we will throw an extra this in. Especially when we're talking about the pay concerns. We were there and it was just, we built in 2%, we always build in 2%, and then it's 5%, then it's 10%. Now we're wondering if the teachers get the 10%, that'll throw everything. The SJC then open up the envelope and again, that throws us in. We just need that certainty. If this happens, we will help you out. We just don't have that, and I think that's it. The certainty that there will be support when support is needed probably is the most important thing for local government at the moment.
Thanks very much for that. And Sean McCauley.
Thanks, Convener. Just to echo again, I think for any organisation, multi-year funding is what you'd be looking for. It helps us with workforce planning. It helps us for medium and long-term financial planning. I suppose, again, the difficulty that we've got is, we had something in place, but you can't foresee challenges that come up within the year. The record inflation meant that, pay awards had to be negotiated and had to be funded as well. So although we had that multi-year funding, last year, that's out of sync now because we had to have these pay awards. So I think even if we're doing multi-year plans or funding plans, then we need to have an opportunity when things don't go as planned that we can have a discussion and reassess our plans at the time. But they definitely, for North, they are sharing them, they've been very welcome, and we would welcome similar in the upcoming budget.
Thank you very much for that. I'm just aware of time. We've got about 20 minutes left in this conversation, and we've got a number of questions. So if I can invite colleagues to direct your questions to specific people, and if the panel can keep their answers as succinct as possible. I think the answers have been fantastic up until now, very important for us to hear everything. And I don't want to restrict you in any way, but we just want to make sure that we cover all the questions. So I'm now going to bring in Miles Briggs.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning to the panel. Thank you for joining us today. We've touched upon this earlier, your comments, Councillor Stockton, with regards to National Care Service. But I just wanted to come back to how the New Deal, potentially, in this fiscal framework could then be impacted by the creation of a National Care Service. And so I'll maybe bring you back in as I named you, if anyone else wants to come in with their view on that.
Yeah, thank you very much. We have been real concerned in the islands about the National Care Service because, as you know, we're small populations, we just don't see the point in having an extra layer of bureaucracy or a different model here. In my own authority, we don't even have any care facilities that are not run by the council. So that the whole thing is together, and we're looking for efficiency. We're looking for the very best use of the public pound coming onto the islands, and we just have some real concerns. Also, issues with regard to VAT and how that's dealt with, issues with regard to where we go with a capital build, because the local authorities, I think the government has sometimes forgets that we have a VAT exemption, which is a huge benefit, which means that the money doesn't go back to the Treasury, but actually we get better value here, you know, if we use, you know, the what local government already has. So we have some real concerns in small areas, particularly that the National Care Service will actually make us less efficient and actually not provide any of the advantage that the government sees.
Does anyone else want to comment on that?
Yeah, I'll be concise. I think in local government, there's a lot of fear that this is the start of the erosion of local government with the National Care Service, and it's just going to strip away the powers, and this is the start of the big wave that's coming. So that is it. It's the fear and the trust with that. We want to deliver social care services the best we can, but we feel this is the erosion of local government, or National Care Service. Thank you.
Okay, that's thanks very much. We've certainly been taking evidence to a great extent on National Care Service, but it's good to hear those perspectives. Now I'm going to move on to questions from Marie McNair.
Thank you, Convener, and good morning, panel. I'd like to ask the panel if any comments on the contribution community councils can make, and whether a view of their role is required, given the most kind of local tier of such representation, the third tier of government in Scotland. But they obviously have very limited resources, powers and influence. Obviously, I know that Councillor Stockton and Nicola have touched slightly on this already, but what's your experiences of community councils and other bodies such as development trusts in terms of driving and delivering local empowerment? And I'll go back to Councillor Stockton, maybe you want to kind of add a wee bit more about the community councils in your area.
Yeah, very much so. I mean, we have always given our community councils a budget to spend to support local things for years and years, and that's been fantastic. We have good uptake until probably the last elections. We've not quite seen so many people coming forward, but that's because we have a kind of a bit of a social issue after COVID that people have been just a bit reluctant to go and get involved in any small committee in our communities. But our community councils are very much part of the whole network of how we govern here, and we pay real attention. Every community council meeting, local members actually attend that as well, right on all of our islands. And it's very much where we hear the view of the community. They are particularly useful, and I do believe that there is challenges, and this is what I was hoping the local governance review would give them, would be the ability to be able to increase their powers so that you could maybe merge a development trust with the community council and have a body that even speaks more clearly for the area. And you know, there's quite a number of things in there, but they are absolutely vital for us, even in this small place.
So do you believe a review of the role is required then?
Well, I think to give community councils additional powers, I think is really important. We have a project of community empowerment that we would like to make sure that community councils are able to do more of the work for the local authority here too. We would like to we put in some link officers between the council and then so they can take on small jobs or identify things that can be done in their community. And we believe that that is one of the best ways to make community work. But you've got to give community council agency if you expect them, for people to take part in them and people to deliver for the community.
Thank you. I'll pop that out to the rest of the panel if anybody wants to come in.
We actually have a stack.
Alex, yes, keen to respond to this important question. So Alex Nicol, then Sean McCauley, and then Ewan Jardine.
Thank you very much, convener. I think this in some ways links back to what we were saying earlier about community empowerment. And community councils, I think, are an excellent example of where councils are able to start feeding into communities and from there take it down to a more granular level that we spoke about earlier. But I think it has to be a two-way street, and we have to see the community councils being able to feed back into things such as community planning partnerships that should exist in most councils in whatever form, so that they can actually see how they are helping to make a difference. And I think certainly in the city here, we've seen the number of community councils grow. And at the last elections that we've just seen, we've managed to get 29 out of 30 community councils up and running. Now, I do think we have a role to help nurture the newer ones and help them on their journey. But the more experienced ones, we certainly also have to be listening to and creating the models that allow them to feed back into our decision making, because we can't leave them to be standalone organisations. They have to be part of the bigger picture. And I think that is part of the success in delivering good community partnerships, is having that two-way flow between the various groups.
And it's Sean McCauley. Sean McCauley? We lost him. We've lost Sean McCauley. Okay, let's go to you and Jardine.
Yeah, thank you. It's a very good question, because community councils are probably the most important cog in the wheel in terms of grassroots and community work. And I've for a long time said that local authorities, we're there to facilitate, not always innovate. And it's the community councils who can do that. I'm from Gala Shields, and Gala Shields, you might have noticed recently, was named the happiest town in Scotland, second happiest town in the UK. And I wrote a column how that wasn't down to the work the council was doing, it was down to what the community council was doing. It was down to energise Gala Shields Trust, the work they were doing. Now, when it comes to the election, I might change my tune and say it was all down to what I was doing. But seriously, it is down to their volunteers who are driving forward initiatives. A new market opened up 6 months ago, which has been a success every first Saturday of the month. Things like that that we wouldn't be able to facilitate at council. We gave them funding to do it, but we weren't able to organise it and do it every Saturday. And the trust and the community council working in conjunction with each other. And I think if you go around Scotland, it's not the council who puts on the Christmas lights. It will be the community council or a wing of the community council or a trust. We need to remember that is who is delivering in the community. So it's really important they get more power. And put in my admin policy plan again, I keep going back to it, but more training for community councils, more empowerment for community councils, bringing them to the table. And I think the councillors here will sit at a community council and sometimes they ask us, oh, can you do this? You can do that. There's not that direct link often into the council. They feel that they have to come through the councillor, then to the council. But sometimes I feel we shouldn't even be in the room at the community council. They should be able to bypass us and go straight into the local authority to actually have that influence. So there's maybe some work needing to be done there because councillors, we act like, say, there's 69 in the Scottish Borders Community Council, so that's a lot for us to go around. But if we could just manage it so they feel more empowered to go straight. Thanks.
Thank you. I've noticed that myself as my previous councillor. I'll move on to my next question. There's nobody else wanting to come in. Obviously, just wanted to ask, do you believe that local authorities would like to raise more of their own revenue? And if so, what mechanisms would they use? And really, what's preventing councils from raising more of their own income currently? And are there any kind of UK or international methods or arrangements that you would like to see replicated here? And I'll start with Councillor David Ross. Thanks.
Thanks. Yeah. I mean, as I've said before, I don't think some of the small schemes that are on the table, like the tourism tax or the parking levy, are a substitute for core funding. And I think that's there. Having said that, I mean, I think the discussion I've certainly been involved in, I think we would like to see a general kind of competence to introduce these things rather than specific kind of powers handed down from the Scottish Parliament, because circumstances are different in different places. I know, you know, for instance, I know there are a couple of authorities that are saying, you know, the tourism tax won't help them, but they could have the kind of using the cruise line things would help, and there are other kind of variations of that. So I think it would be welcomed, those kind of powers, but dictating specific kind of powers from the Parliament is perhaps not the way we would like to see it going.
Okay. Put it to you as well, if you want to come in.
Yeah, I think the flexibility to do it would be a real opportunity for local government. I think local government has always had that mindset. We're not there to make money. We're there to deliver services. But actually, we can, if given an opportunity, deliver open money and get there. So we recently set up a company where Apple training, we're training people across Europe on Apple products, on iPads, for our teachers and Inspire Learning, and we will be bringing some revenue, not a vast amount, but that's opportunity to bring in revenue. And there was people who said, oh, we shouldn't be doing that, that's not our job as a local authority. Well, we need to get revenue somehow, we need to be stretching, we need to be looking at it. And I think Councillor Ross is correct when he says the parking tax levy, the tourism tax, that might work for Edinburgh, that might work for Glasgow, but that won't work for Scottish Borders. I'm sure it won't work for Orkney. We need to see what can local authorities start delivering on their own, but be given that framework. I can't give you any ideas on all the ideas now, but if we had that opportunity and the chance, I'm sure we could come with something. But the core funding is the essential part. Before we even look at that, we need to get, as I say, the day job right, and then we can start looking at other options.
Thank you. Anybody else want to come in on that question? OK. I'll move to my last question then, just obviously...
James, maybe ask your question, but James would like to come in on that. But ask your question and then we'll loop him in.
No problem. So the last question, obviously, I'm just asking, can you provide examples of local authority working with other councils to deliver services? I know that in a lot of authorities, you know, that some of the smaller councils that kind of do a lot of shared services. What impact has had this had? And what more can the Scottish Government do to encourage, facilitate and support between councils? Collaboration.
Anybody got any experience in that way? I think we've lost Sean, and he might have been able to speak to that more fully. Yeah. Ewan?
Yeah, I think it's important to have shared services. So where we are on the Scottish borders, we're bordered with South Lanarkshire, Midlothian, Dumfries and Galloway. So I've set up meetings with all the leaders from these different authorities to speak to them, and I had a chat with Councillor Joe Fagan from South Lanarkshire last week, and we're going to be setting up a working group from... the cross for rural issues. So there's a border literally stopped between, I think it's Broughton and Skirlin, but people work and communicate and socialise in both areas. So we might fix the road till there, they fix the road, but actually can we start sharing the services, start looking at, we can look at maybe cross-border with our carers, etc. So save them driving all the way and we can start working there, and you've got IT services. Sometimes it doesn't work. I know we did a lot of work with Midlothian, but what you find is, we might be using different systems to what they're using. And I think that's the thing. If we all had the same system, or that might work better. That's the issue that we always find, is the systems are always the one that pull it down. We want to, but sometimes it's the way each council ran, and each council's got its own individual flair, so to speak. But I think it's important we have the conversations across boundaries and see what we can. Sometimes at a very basic level, doesn't need to always be the high level. I think that's important.
Thank you. Anybody else wanting to come in?
So Alex Nicol wants to come in on this one, and then we'll bring James Stockin in to pick up the other question. Oh, and David Ross.
Thank you very much, Convener. I think my point would be we have to balance that we are not going down a centralisation route, but we are actually improving delivery of local services, and I think there is a balance to be struck there. I know up here we have the Northern Roads Alliance, where a group of councils actually collaborate in terms of materials and delivery in terms of road infrastructure, and that certainly does provide helpful routes for the various partners in it. So I think there are things that we can do, but I think we have to be careful that we don't end up centralising beyond the point that we lose control, and therefore some of the services that are being delivered are actually being taken out with our own control. There is a fine balance in there. Hopefully what we are currently doing, we're getting right. But I think we have to be careful on that one.
Thanks. And so sticking with this one, David Ross, you wanted to come in.
Just very, very briefly, I mean, I think there's limited scope, I think, for shared services. I mean, I think that's been a suggestion of revenue funding if you can offer services to another authority. I mean, the experience was that everybody wanted to sell their services to somebody else, but nobody wanted to buy them. So that is a problem. Although, like the Northern Alliance, I think Tayside, we're not part of it, but Tayside have joint arrangements on kind of roads and that. I think the other point I want to make, though, is the opportunities, I think, in the city region deals for collaboration. And for instance, we're part of two, so Tay City's deal. I know there's a lot of digital collaboration on digital access and accessibility. And in terms of the South East Scotland, Edinburgh and South East Scotland city region, a joint approach to employability and training and employment engagement with employers, because it is a regional, you know, economy. So I think there is a lot of mileage in those kind of arrangements and frameworks.
Thanks. I'm going to bring in James Stockin, and also I think Sean McCauley is... Nope, he's not online. We had him back, but now he's gone. So, James, come on in on the previous question and this one as well.
Well, thank you very much. Shared services are difficult for islands because we've got that, you know, very difficult water boundary around us. But so we can, among the islands, we share bits and pieces, but they are very limited. But I wanted to come back on the whole thing about revenue generation, because one of the things that we must ensure that if we have revenue generation, it is not then a position where the government can reduce our core funding against one area against another. I mean, at present, in Orkney, we put into our budget more money from our reserves and from the harbour operation, where we generate some money, than we actually take in council tax, which is substantial. But at the same time, we get a smaller budget settlement from the government. So in other words, the extra effort we're putting in is the Scottish government using our money to support the rest of the country. So if we are going to generate in the future, we've got to make sure that that's clearly identified and it's something extra rather than something that's a replacement for the government.
Thanks very much for your responses. Very helpful.
Thank you very much. Yeah, it was an interesting part of our discussion. We've got a couple more questions to go to now, and we are at past, so I trust that it's okay that we go on for maybe 5 or 10 minutes. Paul McLennan.
Yeah, thank you, convener. Thanks, panel. I'll try and answer the two at the same time, just for brevity. The first question was around about the programme for government last year mentioned about the introduction of a local democracy bill within this parliament. I'm just wondering what your views were on that one. And the Scottish Government also in its Butte House agreement with the Scottish Greens committed to establishing a working group to oversee engagement on local government funding, including council tax. Again, just to see if you've been involved in that process and any initial thoughts on that one. And David, I'll probably come to yourself first of all and then open it up after that, if that's okay.
I'm not entirely sure what was intended with the little democracy bill and whether it subsumed the issues that were raised in the governance review.
I suppose in terms of what the discussions we've had, is there anything else you would like to see in that you've not mentioned so far?
No, I think most of it, I think we've probably covered. Sorry, what was the second?
The second one was around about the Butte House agreement, talking around about engagement and local government funding, including council tax, and yeah. Where, you know, have you been involved in that process, and
yeah.
What would you like to see in the future in that regard? We know we've looked at this issue in the past.
Yeah.
There was a commission, there seemed to be a lot of different ideas, and nothing was agreed upon, but just from your own council's yeah. Point of view, what your thoughts?
I mean, I think it's dragged on for a long time. Personally, I think I would like to see some resolution on the non-domestic rates and that more devolved, although recognising there needs to be an equalisation process in that. I think just you're raising finance and slightly off the beam, but take the opportunity. I mean, I think going back to the issue about we need, you know, certainty, and sometimes in the previous budget negotiate, we've had a budget set and then there's been a lot of kind of negotiations on, which has been, whilst we've got extra money out of that as local government, I think it hasn't helped with the certainty. I think the other thing to on the finances, over the pandemic we have had a lot of kind of one-off funding, and I think we're going to face a real kind of problem if and when that is withdrawn, because that has been built into expectations of services and such like.
Is there more flexibility required for councils to raise their own funds? We've talked about, obviously, the workplace yep. parking levy and the tourist levy sort of one. Is there more of an ability that you'd like to see as your council being able to look at other things they would like to propose and pick these if required? And again, I'll ask the same question probably to you next, just to yep. give them the heads up. But just on that, is that more freedom you would like in that regard to look at?
Yes, but it's not obvious to us what we could do, yeah. So it's the general power, I think. Rather than specifics.
Yeah. David, thank you for that. Ewan, yourself?
Yeah, it's the general power to have that flexibility to raise it. So and what works for our areas, say the parking levy, the tourism, that might work for the cities, but rurally it would not work. So what would work for us to create opportunity and create that money?
Just to clarify that, you know, in conscious time, it's more the ability to see what, you know, it's more that ability in the principle.
Yeah.
Looking at what you could do and raise funds.
Yeah, we welcome, as long as it doesn't affect the core funding and think, oh, yeah. They're doing it that way.
An addition of
would certainly be.
Okay. And just in coming back, obviously, I mentioned about the council tax, and again, you know, any other thoughts on that or regarding the local democracy bill, if there's anything you've not mentioned in terms of what we discussed today, is there anything else you wanted to add?
Yeah, I think we've mentioned most of it. I think it's that acceptance of difference. I think that's there. We deliver a very different service to what the Scottish Government done, and everybody in Scotland, local authority, is different. And I come back again to the trust and the respect. And I think if you get Scottish local government right and fund it right, your inboxes will drastically reduce. And I think that's the important thing. I worked at the Parliament for a while, and I know 95% of what came through that inbox was local government issues that the local councillor should be dealing with, not an MSP on that level. And I think we get that right, our mailbox comes down, and people are happier and they're more content. I'm not saying everybody's going to be as happy as Gareth Shields, but people are going to be happier, and I think that's true. We need to get that right.
Good wee plug there, Ewan. Well done. In terms of just the other two, I mean, probably come to yourself, James, and then Alex, just to conclude. Again, James, just on the first point around about anything else in the local democracy bill, and any thoughts on the council tax and specifically local funding that you might yourself want to do in Orkney's and Niles generally?
Yeah, well, I think we will have opportunities where we're quite disappointed that, you know, the whole idea that the Crown Estate money, you know, through the Smith Commission was going to all be going, all the revenue was going to be going to the local authorities, and that would have helped us enormously, whereas the government seemed to have retained particularly a lot of the money that has been from the ScotWind leases. We think that people need to have a refreshed look at that. There's a lot of things in there, but what I would like to finish up by saying is, if we don't get the budgets in place for local government, we are the people who will be able to do the early intervention and the prevention. And if we don't, if it's those areas that go first when our funding is cut, these are the areas that every other part of the government services require for us to deal with. And I think just through this time, we've got to be very cognizant of the fact that if we don't have enough money, we're going to have bigger budget necessity across the other services other than local government. Thank you.
James, thank you. And finally, Alex.
Thank you very much. I don't think of anything particularly to add to the first part of your question, but the second part, I think what we need where we have levers to increase our income generation schemes, we need flexibility, because what works in Aberdeen won't work in Edinburgh, might work partly in Glasgow and probably won't work at all in the islands or in some of the rural parts of Scotland, because we're all in a slightly different position. So I do think flexibility is key, but that money has to be additional. It cannot be in place of funding coming from government, because, as you'll know, the City of Aberdeen has a very high take for NDR, but the consequence of that is that our grant is substantially lower than many others across the country. So I do think that is an area that is a difficult circle to square, but we need to actually address it, and we need to actually say what is fair funding for local councils, because at the end of the day, the cost of educating a child in Aberdeen is probably very similar to the cost of educating a child in many other parts of the country. And, you know, I think while we have flexibility in terms of things such as council tax, we are probably not able to use levers such as that very much in the foreseeable future because of the economic situation that the country finds itself in. And, you know, families are facing hard times and people are having to make really tough decisions. And some of these levers possibly aren't open to us at this time. Thanks.
Alex, thank you for that. Thanks, convener.
Thanks, Paul. And that brings us to the end of our questions. And I think it's been a very good discussion. Certainly, I'm left with requests for flexibility, certainty, reduction of bureaucracy. So it's been really good to hear from you around the New Deal for local government in general and getting into some of the detail. I think it's also very helpful for us to hear when you bring in those kind of specific details and we kind of understand that nuance that happens across councils, and it's really clear that you are working with very different circumstances. So I'd like to thank our panel of witnesses for your evidence today, and I now suspend the meeting for 5 minutes to allow for a change of witnesses. Thank you. We'll now begin our second panel of witnesses this morning. On panel two, we're joined by Councillor Shona Morrison, who's the president of COSLA, and Sarah Waters, who is the director of membership and resources at COSLA. And we're joined in the room by Clellan Snedden, who is the chair of SOLIS. I welcome our witnesses to the meeting and remind all members and witnesses to ensure that their devices are on silent and that all other notifications are turned off during the meeting. Committee members will direct their questions to a specific witness where possible, but if anyone else wishes to come in, please indicate your desire to do so to the clerks. And for those participating remotely, you can do this by typing anar in the chat box in BlueJeans. I'd like to begin our second evidence session with a few questions. Thinking and kind of initially thinking broadly about the progress that's been made with the New Deal, I think I'm going to direct this, Shona, I'm going to give you a heads up. So I'm going to direct this initially to you. So last month, the committee received a written update from the Scottish Government on the New Deal. And I'd be interested to hear from you how COSLA feels about the progress of the New Deal. The government's update spoke about agreeing a new deal in advance of the next financial year. Do you think this is a feasible timescale and what needs to be agreed before a deal is struck?
So thank you, Convener. Good morning, Committee. Good morning. Apologies for not being there in person, but it's currently snowing very heavily in Moray, so I'm happily ensconced in my warm living room. So on the new deal, so as everybody I'm sure will be aware, but just for some context, the New Deal was announced in the spending, resource spending review back in May 2022, and obviously was mentioned in programme of government as well, Scottish Government committing to agree that New Deal. So for us, there's two main strains within that New Deal. So one being the fiscal framework, which I'm sure we'll get into a little more detail later on, and the other being the partnership agreement, which we're committed to. So around that fiscal framework, we've had comment from our leaders, and many of which you've heard this morning already, and some great points have been made by my colleagues at COSLA, from COSLA leaders. So an agreement of principle, so promoting stability, certainty, transparency, affordability and sustainability in a fiscal relationship. Promoting effective use of fiscal flexibilities, and again, that was talked at length by my colleagues this morning, and levers to address local priorities that improve outcomes and enable discussion of fiscal empowerment of local government. And lots of that work, joint work, is continuing at pace at the moment. The other area is around that partnership agreement. And obviously, you know, our real focus on that is, you know, the partnership approach, and that not just be warm words, but, you know, absolutely built on mutual respect and trust. So we really want to ensure that that relationship is strong and those priorities are agreed on before we really commit to signing off on that partnership agreement. So, and we wanted to underpin a mature dialogue and a mutual understanding of our priorities going forward. So with regards to timeline, Convener, what I would say so far is that we're continuing to engage. We've had great access when it comes to dialogue with our ministerial colleagues. So certainly since I've been in the presidential role and my vice president, Stephen Heddle. So we have monthly relationships with Mr. McPherson about that's a sort of relationship building meeting. We also have our strategic review group, which is co-chaired by myself and the Cabinet Secretary for Social Justice, House and Local Government. And more recently, we had our first meeting, which was we were delighted to attend, and that was in the Joint Working Group on Deliberative Engagement and Sources for Local Government Financing, including Council Tax. So that's currently co-chaired by Mr. Arthur and Mr. Harvey, and we're having some discussions on what that will look like in the future going forward, because I do believe that a previous iteration was co-chaired by COSLA. So we would be really keen if we were able to re-adopt that position, understanding that a lot of the work will have to do with the revenue raising within local authorities. So that's me for now. Let colleagues.
Thank you very much, Shona. Cleland.
Thanks, Convener. I'll be brief on this particular point as an opening point. We would welcome the focus on a renewed partnership. The local governance review feels like a bit of unfinished work. It wasn't a local government review, it was a local governance review. All local authorities then engaged its communities about all of the public sector bodies who were active in their area, and we got some very clear feedback from communities about what they would like to see in terms of a better integration, a greater level of influence over the delivery of public services, but that includes the services that councils deliver. I think for us, looking at the partnership agreement, the President was correct. It's not just warm words. What we would want to see is that reflected in behaviours and in actions. So a partnership agreement in writing, a document, isn't the end goal. What we want is a different relationship, as I said, that's featured in the subsequent actions. And I'm sure there's plenty of other questions in relation to the fiscal framework. Thanks.
Can I just go a little bit deeper in there in terms of a change in behaviour? So could you give us some examples or an example of a change that would build that trust?
So there are too many examples of announcements, initiatives that don't fully engage local government in their development. This morning you've heard the evidence around the National Care Service. The National Care Service affecting a core part of local government. The bill was given to the presiding officer before it was shared with local government. We had no input to the construction of the bill, and actually we got it 24 hours before it was laid before Parliament. So there are examples that you'll find around the way that pieces of work are continually brought forward. Quite often, we then get a subsequent apology. We engage with senior civil servants, but there are too many repetitions of that type of lack of engagement, and we are ending up retrofitting a number of kind of policy announcements rather than being involved at the beginning of the policy. Working with colleagues in Scottish Government around how those can be fulfilled, how they're implemented. And generally, when we are early engaged, then it makes for a better implementation. And there's terrific examples of really good work between the Scottish Government and local government during the COVID period. We would want to see that replicated.
Do you have any understanding why this pattern or this feeling of too many examples of things being brought forward and councils not being included? Do you have a sense of why that happens?
Only a personal view. Quite often, I think there's too often local government is viewed as being a delivery body for national government. We're not. We have a separate democratic mandate. The elected members are elected by their constituents to represent their area, and that includes making decisions in respect of the priorities and how you deliver on those areas. But we hear quite often a frustration from ministers that local government just doesn't simply do what they wish us to do. And that's not local authorities being difficult around that, but quite often the implementation of certain actions, the specialism sit in local government. So having an aspiration in policy terms and having the clear understanding of what it takes to implement it is sometimes very different.
Thanks very much for that. I'm going to move on to another question. Still sticking with the New Deal for Local Government. Sean, I'm going to come to you just to be interested to hear if you've got, I mean, I know we had the session before and you've been watching it, but if you want to highlight or underscore or bring anything new in terms of what you would like to see in the New Deal between the Scottish Government and local government.
So I suppose priorities for us, like I've already mentioned, Convener, would be that, and I think Mr. Sneddon's covered that incredibly well, about building on that relationship and ensuring parity when it comes to decision making, and also ensuring that that real early discussion and co-production is key to our relationship and absolutely underpins our new deal. As Mr. Sneddon said, we know our communities as elected members to local authorities, we know our communities incredibly well. And often we have that very current experience to inform any sort of decision-making. So co-production, absolutely key. And the other point I would make again is around flexibilities. Now again, that was made very clear by my colleagues this morning about that need for greater flexibilities within local government spend. We currently have about 60% of our budget is directly spent. And there's a clear desire and appetite for councils to have much more freedom around where that revenue goes and how it is best spent within their local communities. So that would be my 2 points. Thanks, Convener.
Thanks for that, Shona. Could you just go a little bit deeper there? Be interested to hear how you think a new deal would support the 6 outcomes set out in your new five-year plan.
Well, around the local democracy, I suppose that would be our key point, and that goes for sustainable funding. So that's again back to that flexibility of spend. As you'll be aware, our lobbying position has been very clear over the last couple of weeks. We are facing immense challenges, probably the most worrying set of challenges we've seen in local government for many, many years. So that need for us to have control over spend and ensure that public money is spent in the best way possible to ensure the best outcomes for communities would be our clear priority.
Thank you very much for that. I'm going to now bring in Paul McLennan with some questions.
Thank you, Convener, and good morning, panel. I just wanted to touch a little bit more on the New Deal, in particular and about the National Care Service, and what your thoughts are on where you think that's going to be impacted by the National Care Service. Shona, I'll probably come to yourself and then obviously come across to Cleland and that point of view, but particularly just on the New Deal and the National Care Service.
Really clear from cause.
Shona, I think we kind of lost at the start. I think we kind of lost you at the start. I don't know if you wanted to start again, if that's okay.
Of course, that's okay. I'm hoping the snow isn't affecting anything too much. Thanks, Paul. Again, my colleagues spoke to COSLA's position, clear position on the National Care Service. We absolutely support many of the recommendations in the Fully report. And the huge benefit of many of those recommendations, but it's quite clear that as a whole, across party, there are quite significant concerns when it comes to the bill as it stands just now. And I know that my colleague, Paul Kelly, who's spokesperson for health, has spent several days giving evidence to committee about those concerns. And again, leaders touched on that this morning around that quite real concern about centralisation. And also, we have so many current challenges at the moment that leaders do feel that the time taken up in the development of the bill as it stands is potentially going to cause significant issues within local authorities at a time where we could be implementing, changes to try and improve people's outcomes here and now.
Okay, Shona, thank you. Cleland?
Through your chair, if I was going on mastermind, my specialist subject would be the National Care Service. I will keep this as brief as I possibly can. The fault lines in health and social care go back, and there has been literally decades of underfunding of care. What has meant is that demand outstripped the resources available, what was introduced was a prioritisation and aid framework which allowed 4 categories. And as the resources get tighter and tighter, assessments got more and more difficult because effectively they were only providing services to critical and substantial categories 1 and 2, 3 and 4, which would have helped with supportive preventative interventions were unaffordable. So over a long period of time, individuals going through a process of a difficult assessment, at the end of which they were not getting all the care that they needed, led to a huge level of dissatisfaction. So those fault lines were in place before COVID arrived. When the review was undertaken by Derek Feely, what he heard was the frustration and the upset for those who were receiving services or those who were carers. The subsequent consultation saw us, COSLA, and a raft of different public sector bodies responded back to say that the consultation itself was fundamentally flawed. It set out a single model of alternative to individuals and said, do you want to stick with the status quo? Well, obviously they didn't. Or do you want this one single model of an alternative, which was a national care service? So overwhelmingly and unsurprisingly, you've got people saying, no, I don't want to stick with the status quo. And if they're given the only other option, which was a national care service, they then opted for it. The subsequent work around an alleged co-production of a model, where you've got 150 people on a Teams call, half a dozen of whom might get
speech. Sorry, just coming back, and I'm trying to bring it back.
Yeah.
More to the New Deal, if you know what I mean. Does it impact on that? Because we're obviously taking evidence a lot on the National Care Service and that decision, but it's more about how that would impact on the New Deal in terms of that, in your thoughts on that. Because, I'm not knocking back the evidence you're given, because I think we've heard that from Solis as well in terms of that, but more than the New Deal aspect of it.
So the end of that narrative is effectively to say that we've got a proposal on the table that's unaffordable, unimplementable in terms of delivery of the anticipated outcome. It's absolutely unclear as to how we'd do so. What would be the effect of a proper partnership agreement around this, which would, that would, as the President's just indicated, it would be an agreement between central and local government. If there's investment available to put into health and social care, let's not spend our time constructing a new bureaucratic structure to administer it at a high cost. Let's implement the investment at the front line and actually improve people's care outcomes right now.
Okay, come on, thank you. Shona.
Sarah wanted to come in.
Yep.
Sarah, come on in.
Yeah, thank you. I think it just in relation to National Care Service and the impact on the New Deal, I think two things I would raise is, when Clelyn said that, you know, the LGR, it feels very much like unfinished business. And I think if we were to take the principles of a local democracy, a local governance review, and apply them up alongside the National Care Service, I don't think would fare very well in terms of community functional and fiscal empowerment. So I think there's something that sits quite uncomfortably there. I think the other issue, a key part of the New Deal, is a fiscal framework. And that is setting the kind of fiscal rules or the funding rules between local and central government. And Councillor Ross talked this morning about a percentage to local government. Well, clearly taking care out of councils will severely disrupt the funding that goes to local government and all the ancillary services that sit within local government. So I think we'll really have to think really carefully about those rules if the National Care Service goes ahead. And I suppose finally, you know, the types of principles that we're talking about in the partnership agreement space, again, don't sit comfortably with the way in which the National Care Service was developed. So certainly if we do develop a partnership agreement, I think it would definitely be local government's aspirations that the way in which the National Care Service was developed would not happen again if we developed clear kind of rules and principles for working together.
I think that's really helpful, and you kind of led me into my next question, which I'll ask Shona. It really talks around about the fiscal framework, around about what you would like to see out of it, Shona, and obviously I'll come around the rest of the panel in terms of that. You heard from the local council leaders in terms of that, but around about the fiscal framework itself, what is it you would like to see out of the fiscal framework from a COSLA point of view, and then of course I'll then come to Solis. But Shona, yourself first of all.
Thanks, Paul. What would we ideally like to see out of fiscal framework? Well, I guess it would be stability would be our main priority, and that ability to meet new and emerging needs in, you know, a reactive manner. You know, I appreciate colleagues spoke earlier, and I think it was a point that's important to reiterate around a fixed budget, but within that still the ability to be able to revisit discussions with Scottish Government, because as we've seen over the last couple of years, we just seem to leap from crisis to crisis. So, and local government does that incredibly well. And I think the partnership work that we've seen during COVID was commendable between the Scottish Government and local government. So, so sustainability, that ability to meet new and emerging needs, and increased flexibilities, which I think we've covered quite considerably so far this morning.
Shona, just on that, and then I'll come across to Claire, one of the key things that was mentioned by councillors was at the very start of the process, rather than saying here's the budget at the end of it, here's where you're kind of going with that. Is there more work needing done at the start of the Scottish Government budget process in terms of obviously more COSLA involvement or formal COSLA involvement at that stage? That was kind of commented on by councillors, so I don't know what your thoughts would be on that one, if that's a takeaway for us in that regard.
We will always absolutely embrace any early discussion when it comes to a budget, Paul. I'm really, really keen to have those discussions, and you know, absolutely, we'll do our best. Obviously, we have our lobbying position, and we had the opportunity at the parliamentary reception recently to talk to colleagues from the committee as well about the pressures that we're experiencing. So always absolutely delighted to be able to have those early discussions. And like I say, we have access to ministers to progress the discussions, but New Deal has been great. We have our monthly meetings with Mr McPherson, and we also have our strategic review meetings with the Cabinet Secretary, Shona Robinson. So, and all that has been incredibly helpful. So absolutely, COSLA is always willing and ready for any discussions on budget.
Thanks, Shona. Yeah, Cleland, anything to add on that at all?
Yeah, so all of the elements around flexibility, stability, etc. And you heard this morning from Councillor Ross, when he spoke about almost like shared fortunes, if local government shared the fortunes of the Scottish Government going forward, that would include discussions around shared priorities that might come out of the partnership agreement or a review of the national performance framework. We need to think about baseline, that's the point. And Councillor Ross indicated, and everybody will be familiar with the SPICE graph that demonstrates 2013-14 onwards, etc., that the Scottish Government real terms increase was 4.3%, local government was 4.2%. However, we asked Audit Scotland, as part of my council's audit report this year, to do something additional for us. We asked them to strip out the funding that had been given to local government for specific priorities, directed funding or ring-fence funding. Actually, the cut to the core services of local government was a real terms cut of 9.6%. So just to roll a couple of figures for committee today, if you took the 13-14 baseline position for local government, which was a block of 9.27 billion pounds, then that 9.6 reduction would be around about £890 million. So quite close to the COSLA baseline position. If, however, it was a swing, if we'd shared the same fortunes as Scottish Government, it would have been a 13.9% swing from our current budgets, yeah. And that would be around about 1.289 million. So that is just to give an illustration of that.
I suppose the question in plain devil's advocate for that one, obviously there would be shared priorities in that as part of it. So I think that's important to have that context as well. I wanted to move on to Sarah, want to come in? Sorry. Sarah, my apologies.
Yeah, just in relation to Mr McClellan's talk about what we'd like to see in a fiscal framework, I think for me there'd be a couple of things. I think, yes, very much kind of the rules around what we could expect. And I think sometimes there's a feeling that the budget is very much done to us as opposed with us. So rules about the kind of expectations from the outset. I think another important part would be space for kind of structured, honest discussions about demand and pressures. You look back to 2007-08, when a lot of funding was rolled up into, there was a lot more flexibility arrived at through the Concordat. But I think there's a reality that there was policy commitments baked into that clearly now cannot be delivered in the funding quantum that was put in 2007-08. So we do need a realistic discussion on what can be delivered with that money. And I think just finally, another point that I would like to see in a fiscal framework is a process for sort of more speedy and constructive discussions on things like revenue raising, so a process to do it so that we don't have to go back to develop primary legislation every single time. There would be a route for that quick discussion, exploration, and then do what we can within the current legislative framework or do it jointly, but I think more quickly.
Sarah, thank you for that. I think that's really helpful. My final question kind of moved on. During the summer, the committee commissioned some research looking at how local authorities around Europe raised their own revenues, and it just be see in terms of looking at that, we kind of touched upon it with council leaders talking around about the working place parking levy, for example, or the tourist visitor levy, in terms of that. How would COSLA, and I'll come to yourself, first of all, Shona, is that something obviously in principle you would support, and is looking at a suite of measures, you know, in terms of having that principle from Scottish Government to raise, for local authorities to raise their own taxes or our own fundraising opportunities around about that. I just wondered what you thought on about that. And if that was the case, how would you like to see that proceed in terms of that? Because I think one of the key things, I think, for me would be giving each local authority, and this was touched upon by the local council leaders, something to do in terms of their own local context. What might work in Borders might not work in Highland, might not work in Moy, but it gives them the opportunity to look at additional fundraising opportunities on top of the budget that they have at the moment. But just in principle, has COSLA looked at that, and has any ideas how we'd like to see that proceed if that was the case?
Yeah, thanks, Paul. And I think you've outlined the areas that we have done some work on previously. So around local tax raising, so if it's a levy and working parking levy. So those two areas are ongoing, and you know, we continue to pursue discussions around them. I think that's key, really, that real local aspect to you know, local revenue raising, that we have to ensure that councils are given the powers that they need, as Sarah said, to be able to react quite quickly to look at what would work best for their own authority. So absolutely embrace the opportunity to be able to do that. And again, that's been built into our conversations. We've had a regular conversations with Deputy First Minister with regards to flexibilities as well. So I think the joint working group that I mentioned earlier on, that we had our initial meeting with Mr Arthur, Mr McPherson, Mr Harvey last week, is a really good space to have those discussions. I mean, that is on local government funding, and within that sits obviously council tax as well. So, and that's very sort of focused on, I suppose, those kind of measures that we can look at that aren't protracted through heavy legislation and what have you, or a primary legislation rather, and we can look at kind of moving the conversation on quite quickly and developing procedures that we can put in place so local councils can be reactive. So that feels like a really good space. Like I say, we've only had our initial meeting, but it was and it's certainly grounded within that sort of deliberative engagement as well, so ensuring that whatever proposals are put forward, that our communities absolutely have the opportunity to co-produce, because again, they absolutely are tuned into what they need and require in their own environments.
Thanks, Shona. Clellan, just on that, I mean, one of the example other countries were looking at was, for example, like a local sales tax, and the local authorities had the ability to do that. Yeah, so that's not what I'm proposing, but that kind of gives an example sort of thing. I mean, from a chief executive point of view, what your thoughts on the same question, you know, is looking at that ability for each local authority to look at different fundraising opportunities. How would you like to see that, or how, from a SOLAS point of view, would you like to see that proceed, considering obviously what Sean has mentioned as well?
So it's correct, there should be the flexibility for local authorities to act where it's appropriate. We heard this morning that TVT, for example, will work for some authorities and will actually provide some reasonable income, but it won't work across the board. I suppose the way I liken this is, you know, if a fighter plane's flying along and somebody fires a missile at it, it throws out all these sparkly things at the back, it distracts the missile. The conversation around things like TVT and parking levies, etc., could act as chaff It's not a proxy for a proper funding settlement for local government. And I'll go back to the council tax, which is one of the levers. We need to be thinking about the future funding of local government much more fundamentally. We need something that's much more progressive.
That will come up, I think, later on in some of the questions, but and particularly on the additional or other opportunities for raising funds.
Yeah,
just your thoughts on that one. As I said, the council tax one will come up at a later stage. So.
Yeah, and just the opportunities for councils to be more commercial in their outlook, to have a general competence to allow them to act within their market as appropriate, not to muscle in on the private sector, but where there's market failure, for example, or where there's opportunities and no service delivery, for the authorities to consider new revenue generating proposals. It will be different for different areas. Okay. So it needs to be a general power as opposed to a prescriptive.
Has Solace done any, you mentioned about the general power, which I agree with because it's nice to give you that local flexibility. Has Solace done anything formally in that regard and saying, looking at that, or presenting anything to COSLA or to Scottish Government in terms of that, or would it be something that it would consider?
We would work in conjunction with our colleagues in COSLA around that, rather than doing something separately ourselves as a professional body.
Yeah.
But I think you'll find across the country there'll be examples of authorities acting in a commercial manner.
Yeah. I was previously in council for 15 years and was same one local authority. So.
And sometimes very successfully, etc. So those general powers, we need to explore them. But as I said, and it'll be later in the conversation, these are enhancements as opposed to a replacement for a more progressive way of funding local government.
Yeah. Okay. Well, thank you. I don't know if Sarah wants to come in on that one. If not, that's me. Convene.
Thanks, Paul. Sarah would like to come in.
Sorry, yes. I think I think as well as part of the fiscal framework, and if there is local revenue raising opportunities and exploration, I think we need to think very carefully about the interaction with the local government settlement, because I think what we wouldn't want to see is an awful lot of effort going into local revenue raising that's very appropriate locally for tourism infrastructure or environmental priorities, but then all that happens is there's a deduction from the settlement. So it's a bit like Scottish Government having tax raising powers and then seeing their block grant adjusted because they've raised more tax. You would absolutely want to be able to spend local money raised for local priorities. So, but that is that's something that we do need to consider as part of fiscal framework, is what would that interaction look like?
Thanks, Sarah. Thanks, Camilla.
I'm now going to move on to questions from Willie Coffey.
Thanks very much, Convener. I'd like to ask the same question I asked the previous panel and direct this to Councillor Morrison. You must have heard the responses from Councillor colleagues on progress with the local governance review since 2017. It was hardly rosy, although there were a few glimmers of positivity near the end of it. Could you give us your own perspective, Shona, of how you think that work has gone? And I might as well just roll my second question into this, Convener. Did we put too much expectation to local communities about what the outcome of that review would be? So, firstly, could you give us your perspective on how the review has gone? And secondly, did we perhaps overreach and put in too high expectations about what it might achieve?
Thanks, Willie. I suppose it's been unavoidable, really, that progress was postponed, really, on the local governance review. That was undoubtedly due to a redeployment of resources, understandably, for the Ukrainian response. It's disappointing, but unavoidable. And I think, we're absolutely starting to see green shoots and a movement back into meaningful discussions with Scottish Government. I'll keep with the positive, I suppose, and say that some of the work we're looking at is we've arranged meetings in the new year with Cabinet Secretary Shona Robinson to restart discussions around single island authority and other proposals we have for council leaders. So we are moving on. I suppose an area that I would focus on about what we could have done better, but perhaps we experienced some really good practice during COVID is around, you know, the meaning behind the words of, you know, governance review and not government, as several of my colleagues have already pointed out, and that need for change if we're to be at all successful when it comes to you know, good governance, it has to be cross public sector. And not just local government, not just Scottish Government. So it's about, you know, engaging all of our partners to explore all the solutions that we need to empower our communities and enhance both our local and democratic accountability. So I think, you know, those relationships have been really developed during the last 2-3 years. And, you know, I sat on NHS Grampian board in my last term and seen how successful we were able to work at pace together. So I suppose that's, you know, a really positive byproduct of where we are and the crisis that we've gone through, that we've been able to establish those relationships. And hopefully moving forward, that cross-sector, that cross-public sector approach will be something that we can absolutely harness and drive forward.
Okay, thanks for that. Cleland, same question, really. I mean, there was 2 years' worth of work went on there, 2018, 2019, before it was paused for a number of reasons. But what's your own perspective on what came out of the, or has come out of the review so far in terms of positive direction of travel?
So, I suppose the biggest positive is it's back in the agenda. Consultation phase for the local governance review, I was in Argyll and Bute, my previous authority, and I personally fronted a roadshow that went round quite an extensive area, a lot of island, and did the kind of workshops and roadshow with communities. First thing is, there was a huge appetite for people to be involved in it. There was a real momentum around that. There was a discussion. We had a board at one point with all the public bodies who took decisions or provided service within the area, and it was really interesting that half the bodies weren't known to the local community and were quite often asking, you know, who are they, what do they do, etc. And then when you explained it, you know, they said, well, how do they report to us, how are they accountable to us, etc. So there was loads of really good feedback built up, fed into the process, and then for reasons that the President has explained, it was never finalised. We deliberately set out to talk about local governance, not local government, although the council was a facilitator. And with that lens on it, then it started to open up discussions with communities that were much broader than the services that councils deliver. And had it concluded and produced some enabling legislation, I think it would have produced, in different locations in Scotland, different solutions that reflected the local needs. We need to get away from this one-size-fits-all, or people keep using postcode lottery and all these kind of expressions. That's a nonsense. Scotland's a very diverse country with a lot of diverse communities. So I think it was ready to be presented. It wasn't necessarily an appetite, and I'll just cover this point because I think it's connected with a later question. It wasn't necessarily about ripping more powers out of a local government tier and putting it to a further tier. It wasn't necessarily. What I heard in those roadshows directly from communities, they wanted an influence. They didn't necessarily want to be running services. And in an area like Argyll and Bute, which is enormous but quite a sparse population, you quite often had a single manager running a particular service across that huge geography. So discussions about, we would like to take on our own planning functions, etc., and we want our own planning manager. There's one planning manager for the whole of Argyll and Bute. So, you know, it was helpful in managing expectations and opening up a very honest dialogue with communities about how they wanted to input to decisions that were made on their behalf.
Okay.
Is that helpful?
Yeah, certainly very helpful. I don't know if Shona has signalled. Not Shona, Sarah.
Yeah, if I can maybe just come in, I suppose I think local government's expectations were raised through the local governance review, and I think there was a hope that it would be the way in which some of the ideas that were and work that was done through community planning partnerships could actually gain a bit of traction, especially in the functional and the fiscal empowerment bit. So it would actually be the kind of means by which you could join up budgets, look at property differently, you know, do things that potentially there had been barriers to before. But I think it is interesting now that the local governance review is part of the New Deal for local government. And I think we just need to be careful that, you know, it cannot just be confined to, you know, local government. It has to push across the different public sector partners as well. And, you know, there was a lot in the resource spending review about public sector reform. And there was a bit in the resource spending review about local government taking a complementary approach to the public sector reform agenda. I think we need to join all these things up. So actually we're thinking about how is local governance done? What's in this New Deal? What can community planning partnerships achieve? And how can we make services better using all the resources that we have? How can we make outcomes better for people on the ground?
Okay, thanks very much for that. Happy with that, convener?
Yep, thank you. And Sarah, thanks for that, kind of just underscoring the point that the noticing that the local governance review has been tucked into the New Deal for local government, and that we need to kind of be mindful of that. I'm now going to move on to questions from Marie McNair.
Thank you, convener, and good morning, panel. Councillor Morrison, the previous COSLA president told the committee last year that local government review pilots are kind of all written up and ready to go. Could you tell us a bit more about these pilots and any other local projects relating to the review's three empowerments?
Sorry, Marie, can you repeat that?
I was just saying, obviously, the previous COSLA president told the committee last year that councils have local government review pilots written up and ready to go. I'm just really wanting to know, can you tell us a bit more about those pilots and any other local projects? Obviously, maybe bring in Sarah. Obviously, you're just newly elected.
I'm going to have to, Marie, I'm afraid, Sarah. I'll have a little bit more detail.
Not a problem. Cheers. Sarah.
Yeah, so there were 11 or 12 pilots that or proposals that had been put forward, and I remember them being discussed at my very first and last meeting at the Scottish Parliament just before COVID. The 12 proposals had come forward. Obviously, the Island Authority, single island authorities form part of that, but so too did single public authority models in some of our other areas. So, for example, in Scottish Borders, that was a proposal that was put forward. There were other things around data sharing, and actually, I think we absolutely need to revisit that list and almost, I don't want to say close them off, but actually review them in the kind of post-COVID context and see which ones we actually want to take forward, or which ones actually have moved forward anyway because of maybe working practice during COVID or work that we've been doing, for example, with DWP around data sharing. So some of those proposals actually covered those areas. So I think we do need a stock take. I think there's a feeling now that obviously there's been some cabinet interest in the single island authority model, but actually I think we would like to look at the 12 proposals that came forward and just assess which ones are still relevant and which ones perhaps local authorities would want to see maybe slightly amended to take account of the current context.
Thanks, Sarah. Clelyn, would you like to share your view on that?
Very similar. They were of their time. So there was a set of pilot projects that were described in short order, but they never moved into proper implementation phase. I think we need to go back, revisit these. I think we need to look at it from today's lens as well. Ultimately, we need to be clear about the purpose of such pilots, etc., and how they will actually benefit communities, how they will deliver a set of outcomes. So I think it'll look slightly different today than the list that Sarah mentioned in 2019, but I think Sarah's right. We should take a stock take on that original list and refresh it and look to expand on it. But again, we need to do so with a view to what enabling powers might be needed to help these get over the line. Yeah.
Thank you for that. I'll just move on to my next question. Obviously, I'd like to ask the same question that I'd asked the previous panel of councillors, and really can ask in what are COSLA and SOLAS's view on community councils, and do you think the review is required, regarding the role? Yep. Bring in Cleland.
Thanks, convener. So we have some outstanding community councils in Scotland. high capacity, connect well with our communities, those that they represent, connect well with other community bodies like development trusts, etc., and physically deliver a lot of services on the ground, in addition to their statutory role in things like planning. But it's very inconsistent across the country. There are not that many community councils across the country where there is a true election, a competitive election. I think they would be the first ones to acknowledge they are not diverse. They tend to be men of my age and upwards, very male, very much of my age bracket. And their ability to connect and represent their communities is variable as well. So hopefully that explanation is understood. Therefore, we need to ensure that we empower communities, one body of which in our communities is community councils. And I go back to some of the really progressive work that's been done in community planning across the country, where we are tying in representatives at a neighbourhood level, at a locality level, and connecting them to the strategic community planning level. It's not to sideline community councils, but they are only one of a number of very progressive community bodies. So it comes to the point about what do you do in legislation terms. So I would be really cautious about any blanket direction to take powers from local government to put it to a fourth tier when you've got such levels of variability. And for me, the concern isn't just about the kind of representation and their accountability into their communities, but also one other additional point, and this is a generalism, that those communities who have the highest capacity tends to have the highest capacity community councils. And those communities who have maybe the greatest levels of challenge are quite often the communities where there isn't the same engagement in community councils and there isn't the same capacity to advocate for other communities. And part of the role of local government is to equalise that. So I'm just a bit more cautious than maybe the messages you heard earlier.
Thank you. Sarah and Shona, would you want to kind of add in further? Or Shona?
Ellen's put it incredibly well there, particularly as well. What he described is, I would say, would be my experience of community councils, and that is incredibly variable about performance. We've seen, and leaders related to that during their evidence session, some incredible work done by our community councils and our development trust during COVID, and absolutely, you know, we've done a lot of work in Murray in the last couple of months over resilience building within those groups, and it's been fantastic to see that communities are really engaged. But yes, I would absolutely agree with Cleland that I would say that what we see is incredibly different throughout the country.
Thank you for that. Sarah, do you want to add anything? Or
No, nothing to add.
OK, that's me, Kimura. Thanks.
Thanks, Marie. We're now going to move on to our final area of questions, and that's going to be with Mark Griffin, who's joining us online.
Thanks, Kamina. COSLA launched the budget campaign a couple of weeks ago, I think, and it's fair to say it paints a really grim picture for local authorities if there aren't any changes from the spending review figures. Can I just ask, Shona, what impact would a flat cash settlement have on local authorities? Are you able to set out a breakdown of the extra £1 billion that directors of finance have called for, and do you have any suggestions as to how national government might fund that?
Thanks. I'll certainly bring Sarah in to add some more detail if that's all right. But yeah, absolutely. As you've clearly outlined, we are facing incredible pressures within local government, and also appreciate that Scottish Government is facing a lot of the same challenges. I think Cleland gave you a breakdown of the figures earlier on, but yeah, we're looking about pressures of over £600 million in 2023-24 due to inflation, energy and demand. And demand, as well as recurring pressures of the pay deal, which we absolutely rightly made, but that will be a definite pressure going forward for councils. So, I mean, all that wraps around demographic pressures, increasingly complex care needs, implications of climate crisis, pay pressures, workforce and recruitment pressures, impact of EU exit and COVID. Obviously, we have the National Care Service providing us with quite an uncertain picture at present. So, lots of concerns. You know, I've spent a lot of time with the council leaders recently, listening to some of the situations that they're facing, and we have outlined, you know, quite rightly in our lobbying position and what that might look like. And through various different captions we've taken from different leaders within different authorities. As you've also referenced, we had the letter going in from Director of Finance, fairly unprecedented approach from them. And again, that you know, paints a clear picture of how very concerned we are about our fiscal situation. So I'll perhaps hand over to Sarah, if that's okay, for just some greater detail around the ask.
Yeah, so just in response to Mr. Griffin's question about the kind of what happens if we don't get additional money, I think in our initial budget lobbying document, we set out the scale of the challenge. So what £1 billion would equate to in terms of teacher numbers. It's the entire ELC delivery budget. But what we've said this year, really, the scale of the challenge is such that we cannot see areas that have been previously protected not bearing their fair share of the pressures this year. So, for example, where local government has looked to protect education and care in the past, and the burden has fallen on areas like roads, culture, sport, etc. That's no longer viable, given that it's £1 billion. So what we've done in subsequent releases over last week and this week is set out what would happen if all service areas took their fair share of the pressures. And one that's just gone out today is an interesting one in relation to climate change, because what we're saying is really there's a climate SOS. We know that there's a huge amount of investment required if we're going to meet our net zero targets. And climate change is an interesting one for councils, because there is no specific budget line for climate change. But what we're saying is if we don't see a change in both revenue and capital, meeting those targets will be extremely, extremely challenging. Because it's not a kind of service area per se, so it's difficult to set out, you know, what you would save. But I think what we'd see is the inability to invest across estate, across fleet, all the things that councils need to do to meet net zero. So we have, I think, been quite blunt about the reality of the current spending plans, and for all the reasons that Councillor Morrison set out: energy, inflation, the residual pay gap that still exists this year, and demand in areas, for example, like Ukraine resettlement, that is placing significant demand on some areas, for example, Glasgow, in relation to school transport alone. There's a significant pressure there this year, which carries then into next year.
Thanks for that.
Cleland wanted to come in on that.
Yeah, again, not to repeat, but the impact, just to go back to the original question, it's not just this year, but this year's different. So we'll get 10 years of paring away. Don't get me wrong, creating efficiencies, there must have been fat in the system 10 years ago for us to have survived through most of this period, but increasingly each year has got worse. The effect is if almost a deliberate disinvestment in roads, bridges, leisure, culture, libraries, grounds maintenance, street cleansing, parks and cemeteries, etc., etc. All the things that are not in the protected services around education or social care. And the budget SOS circulars that colleagues in COSLA have been circulating gives an illustration of the kind of impact of that. Can I just put in a slight addition around this, which is in capital? Because we haven't really talked about the capital impact. The capital budgets, the capital grants for local authorities now are so small, we are unable to maintain our estate anywhere near the condition it should be. We're storing up potential problems that are already starting to arise, where you're seeing facilities being closed for the lack of roof repairs, boiler systems, etc. And I want to just put one other nuance in this. So we have got shared targets and shared priorities around climate change. We did a piece of work. Now, South Lanarkshire Council, my council, has arguably the best and most modern school estate in Scotland. We replaced all of our schools, primaries, secondaries, early learning, childcare settings. So our condition of non-domestic stock is better than the average in Scotland by some considerable distance. To hit net zero, sorry, not net zero, to hit zero emissions targets by 2038, we did a piece of work on our non-domestic estate. It will cost us over £500 million to get anywhere near zero emissions. Our capital grant for my authority reduced by a third recently in this year, and it's down to £21 million. That £21 million is to do everything to maintain all our estate, our roads, estate, etc. So our ability to get anywhere near the 2038 target, far less the 2045 target around net zero, is, you know, just do the arithmetic or do the math, as Americans would say. We need to get a very honest and very real conversation about the targets that are set for Scottish local government and our ability to deal with them within the current financial envelope. So just capital was something I hadn't heard discussed earlier, but it falls in the same bracket as the challenges around revenue.
Yeah. Thanks for that. If I can come back to Councillor Morrison briefly, a large part of that £1 billion was on the pay deals and the pay settlement. I just wondered if COSLA were asking on the pay deals, since they were jointly negotiated, if COSLA was going to be asking for those to be baselined to alleviate some of those recurring pressures.
Yes, absolutely.
Thanks for that clarification. I wanted to move on to another area, and that was that the Programme for Government in 21-22 confirmed that the government would introduce a local democracy bill within this parliamentary session. Just wanted to ask what COSLA and Solace would like to see included in that local democracy bill, and perhaps come to the Cleland first.
You don't need to do the... Yeah,
thanks, Convener. So, a couple of things around this. We're aware that the Charter for Local Self-Government has been... The European Charter for Local Self-Government has been bound up by the UK Supreme Court decision. The basic principles within the Charter are fundamental to the future of local government in Scotland. Any bill that comes forward now in relation to local democracy, in my view, should be founded on the principles of that charter. And we need to find a way to ensure that it's within the competence of the Parliament, but still keep those principles in place, because those, at its very core, talk about the role of local government in the governance of this country. And secondly, it talks about the resources being appropriate to allow local government to discharge its functions in those terms. In terms of the flexibilities we spoke about earlier in terms of local governance review, those should feature within the local democracy bill to enable local areas, local partnerships, community planning partnerships, local public bodies to enact changes in function or structure. The three competencies that Sarah mentioned earlier in terms of fiscal, community and functional, it should be flexible as an enabling piece of legislation to allow those to come forward. But avoid, my view, avoid any blanket direction to every area in Scotland to look alike or to be alike or to make change alike, because we have a hugely diverse country. Convener, I'll just keep it short to that point. Thanks.
Thank you. And Shona, do you want to come in on this?
Thanks, Convener. I won't add much more, because I think Cleland's covered a lot of what I would have said, and certainly around the the European Charter, and my vice president would give me a row if I wasn't able to raise that. So, because it's something he spoke at length about the importance of going forward, and I absolutely agree with him. So, I guess just to say that anything that we will look to do is just ensuring that it's built upon once we're concluded with the local governance review that. What we have is built upon those very principles. Thank you.
Thanks. Miles, I believe you might have a supplementary on this particular topic.
I can come in at the end.
Okay, all right. So, Mark, yeah. I think you have some more questions. Yeah.
Yeah. Thanks, Kimmy. Just one final question on local government taxation. The Scottish Government Partnership Agreement between the SNP and the Greens committed to establishing a working group to deliberate on what form local government taxation could take. I just wondered if there are any updates from COSLA and Solace to perhaps how talks are progressing on local government taxation.
Colin, do you like to come in?
I think that's more a question for my colleagues in COSLA. Thanks.
Shona.
Yeah, I can certainly come in. So I think I'd said, Mark, that we had our first meeting of the Joint Working Group on deliberative engagement and social local government funding, which includes council tax, last week with Mr Arthur, Mr McPherson and Mr Harvey. So that really was an initial meeting. So terms of reference been decided, sharing, agenda setting, etc. So you'll appreciate that there was some discussion points within that agenda, but we've been unable to reflect those discussions back with leaders, and that paper will go to leaders in January. So it would be remiss of me to have that discussion just now before I've had it with leaders. So very much a sort of initial meeting, deciding on the terms of reference and agenda setting, etc. So felt very positive. There was some good discussion right at the table, and quite a open, honest environment. So looking forward to our next meeting. Like I say, once we've been able to update leaders, happy to update the committee.
Thank you, Shona. That sounds like it was very constructive. I just wonder what the regularity of the meetings will be. Do you have a sense of that?
It feels like it'll be quite regular, convener. So we don't have a date yet. Again, that'll be once we've had an opportunity to sort of delve into the terms of reference. But we have agreed that anything we do will be moving at pace. So I'm making the assumption that that'll be a very regular meeting.
Thank you very much. And I think, Sarah, you wanted to comment on this.
Yeah, I think the Butehouse Agreement, I think we need to look at it in two parts. I think there's a very kind of immediate set of practical things that the group had started to look at next week. And as Councillor Morrison says, we need to run some of these things past leaders. These are the types of things that we could do within the current legislative framework in the short term. But then we need to think about the other part of that, which is sources of local government funding. That's a very big question, or a very big area to explore, because that covers everything from the funding that we get from Scottish Government, council tax, other revenue raising, NDR, etc. So that needs to really run in parallel to the work on fiscal framework, because really the two are inextricably linked.
Thanks very much. Mark, are you complete with your questions?
Yeah, that's all the questions from me. Thanks, Kavina.
Thank you very much. I'm now going to bring in Miles Briggs.
Thanks, Kavina. It was just following on from those questions, because in the first panel we did hear, obviously, the disparity between island councils, and specifically as an Edinburgh MSP, I'm acutely aware Edinburgh receives one of the lowest shares per head of population, and many of the problems Scotland faces, at least with regards to homelessness, 25% of that is here in the capital, and the council will continuously tell me they don't have the resource to address that. So what are the plans, and maybe touch upon the conversations you're having, Shona, with regards to reviewing that funding formula to look at historically councils which have lost out, like Edinburgh?
Thank you. Thanks. Thanks, Miles. You'll appreciate that those sorts of discussions have been ongoing, and we've had several meetings already with the Cabinet Secretary and Deputy First Minister, as well as Mr McPherson, on funding issues. So we raise that continually. Leaders, do you have, when it comes to distribution and settlement, that does that is a decision, and that paper does go to our council leaders. And that's something that they do have, you know, the ability to influence and obviously feedback to government around as well. So I would say that's absolutely. I mean, I think Mr. Stockin spoke at length about his feelings about distribution, and obviously, you know, with the discussions going forward over single island authority and the other proposals that Sarah alluded to, that's absolutely key to those discussions and how funding is distributed. Sarah might want to add a little bit more detail.
Thanks.
Yeah, I think just, I suppose, COSLA's formal position is that we wanted to look at the fiscal framework before we start looking at distribution, because really the important thing for local government is to increase the size of the pie, not to look at kind of redistributing the pie we already have. So we leaders were absolutely clear that we really wanted to make sure that the fiscal framework was well underway, and then we would look at issues of distribution. Distribution obviously has been reviewed. It was the whole kind of floor mechanism and distribution was reviewed back in 2018. And as Councillor Morrison quite rightly says, every single funding distribution is jointly discussed with Scottish Government. All directors of finance across Scotland have an opportunity to comment, and all decisions go to leaders. Too frequently and too many discussions on funding, we would like to see much fewer distributions and a much kind of simpler process and much more flexibility. But you know, there is a very robust process at the moment.
Glenn, do you want to?
Don't want to add too much, but I've probably got a fairly unique perspective, having been chief executive in a rural and island authority in Argyll and Bute. And now in South Lanarkshire, which is largely urban, but with a fairly large-scale rural population. And it is a perennial debate about trying to get the balance between deprivation-related indicators mm-hmm. and those that reflect rurality, and particularly rurality in a declining population setting. So that work is constantly reviewed by directors of Finance Network, who look at the indicators that will reflect distribution. But the word I wrote before Sarah came in was quantum. Before we start to talk about how we cut the pie up, we need to ensure that the pie is large enough to allow us the delivery of core public services in every area, and thereafter it's nuances. Yeah.
Thanks. Thanks, Camina.
Thank you very much. And that concludes all our questions. Very much appreciate you all joining us this morning for this, I think, very useful and informative discussion. And if does anyone have any final, we've got a little bit more time, and just want to say, if you've got anything final you really want to make sure we hear, I welcome that. But Cleland.
I do so because one of my colleagues will hunt me if I don't. It has been highlighted around the extensive renewable energy infrastructure now here in Scotland, the need for further investment in that infrastructure to ensure that not only can we generate power, but we can get it to where it's needed. And it was pointed out by my colleague who asked me today to ensure that it was referenced that there is considerable impact on, and it was an island authority, considerable impact from offshore wind, etc., yet it kind of bypasses the authorities in terms of revenue generation. Mm-hmm. And if we are looking at progressive taxation models, that's one of the items that some of my colleagues would ask us to put on the table. Thanks.
Thank you very much. And anything from COSLA, from Shona or Sarah? No? Okay, great. Well, thank you very, very much. We agreed at the start of the meeting to take the next three items in private, so as we have no more public business today, I now close the public part of the meeting.